If you love wealth better than liberty, the tranquility of servitude better than the animating contest of freedom, go from us in peace. We ask not your counsels or your arms. Crouch down and lick the hands which feed you. May your chains set lightly upon you, and may posterity forget that you were our countrymen. Samuel Adams.
The time is near at hand, which must determine whether Americans are to be free men or slaves. George Washington.
And what country can preserve its liberties if its rulers are not warned from time to time that this people preserve the spirit of resistance? Let them take arms. The tree of liberty must be refreshed from time to time with the blood of patriots and tyrants. Thomas Jefferson.
Posterity, you will never know how much it costs the present generation to preserve your freedom. I hope you will make good use of it. If you do not, I shall repent in heaven that ever I took half the pains to preserve it. John Adams.
I sincerely believe that banking establishments are more dangerous than standing armies, and that the principle of spending money to be paid by posterity under the name of funding is but swindling futurity on a large scale. Thomas Jefferson.
Government is instituted to protect property, this being the end of government.
When smart businesses need to grow their team, they do it on the site proven to deliver, Indeed.com. According to an independent study, Indeed delivers.
Well, I got a friend named Whiskey Sam. He was my boonie rat buddy for a year and now. He said, I think my country got a little off track. Took him 25 years to welcome me back. But it's better than not coming back at all. Many a good man I saw fall. And even now, every time I dream, I hear the men and the monkeys in the jungle scream. Drive on. It don't mean nothing. My children love me, but they don't understand. And I got a woman who knows her man. Drive on. It don't mean nothing. It don't mean nothing. Drive on. Well, I remember one night, Tex and me rappled in on a hot LZ. We had our 16s on rock and roll, and with all of that fire, I was scared and cold. I was crazy and I was wild, and I have seen the tiger smile. I spit in a bamboo viper's face, and I'd be dead, but by God's grace, drive on. It don't mean nothing. My children love me, but they don't understand. And I got a woman who knows her man. Drive on. It don't mean nothing. It don't mean nothing. Drive on. It was a slow walk in a sad rain, and nobody tried to be John Wayne. I came home, but Tex did not, and I can't talk about the hit he got. But I got a little limp now when I walk, and I got a little tremolo when I talk. But my letter read from Whiskey Sam, you're a walking, talking miracle from Vietnam. Drive on. It don't mean nothing. My children love me, but they don't understand. And I got a woman who knows her man. Drive on. It don't mean nothing. It don't mean nothing. Drive on.
Yeah, welcome to Patriot Smith. My name is Joshua Bennett. I'll be here for the next, so long or so. Talking about things that we really feel like talking about. So in studio today, we have Mr. Mike Anderson. Good morning, Mike.
Morning.
Does that come through good? Say morning. That again, Mike.
Good morning. Am I on?
Yeah, you okay. Are. I'll just crank it up a little bit. All right. So, Mike, we were talking about a few things before the show started, which for some reason we always do. Yeah, maybe if I turn up my headphones, I can hear you better. So, what was the first thing we were talking about? Did we hit like, bam, bam, bam?
I think it was the guy drowning, wasn't it?
No, that was like that was like the third thing.
Oh, okay.
The first thing was something. So the guy drowning. Let's just go to him.
Okay.
So if you folks haven't seen it, there's if you go to the Target Liberty's website, Robert Wenzel's site, which I go to it probably way too many times per day to see what he's got going on. He posted a blog with a video, and he calls it Suburban Primitives in Action. So what this is, a disabled man is out in the middle of a lake drowning, and a bunch of teenagers, punks, film it and just laugh and yell at him and stuff while he's screaming and drowns.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, normally it's like, okay, whatever, bunch of idiot punk kids. Specifically towards libertarianism, but I thought was interesting with the, was with the comments section on Target Liberty, when there's some of the so-called libertarians like, well, yeah, but, you know, no one has a positive obligation, you know, as we talk about positive rights and negative rights, blah, blah, blah. Uh-huh. No one's obligated to save him, right?
Right, and that's what
he didn't violate the non-aggression principle. The punks didn't violate, right. And it's kind of like, okay. And Tom Woods, I think it's the actual Tom Woods, because I know he comments there.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, he says, "Are you kidding me?"
No, I don't.
The non-aggression principle is not the sum-all, be-all for every aspect in life. It's more pertains. I mean, just like we've said before, libertarianism, well, and stuff like that, that's a political philosophy.
Yeah.
Not necessarily just a life philosophy.
Well, and the commenters, you know, their position, it tends to agree with the with what the prosecutors did. You know, they basically let them go on those charges. And I think they filed charges because they didn't report the death.
Right.
But they weren't required to report the guy being in trouble. So they're not in trouble for allowing him to drown and laughing and recording it,
right? Now,
which I'm not, you know, I'm not advocating any law should be written.
No, so. Neither am I, and I'm not saying that they should go to jail particularly or something like that because mm-hmm. they watched someone drown. Were they negatively obligated to help the guy? Maybe not. Probably not. Right? They would have put themselves into danger.
Well, the reality is,
and this and that, but.
Yeah, the reality is they probably didn't know how.
That's true, too. But, you know, the whole thing is if they would have just watched and like, oh, gee, or maybe called someone, the whole uh-huh. point of that video is that they sat there and laughed and were mocking the guy while he drowned.
Right.
That's what puts a sour taste in your mouth.
Yeah.
That's the part where you want to throw one of them out in the middle of the lake and laugh at them while they drowned. So this is more of a... I suppose this story is more of a insider libertarian argument of what is a positive right, what's a negative right, what's an obligation, and what's not an obligation.
Uh-huh.
And sure, maybe according to the non-aggression principle, they weren't obligated to go help them. They could have put themselves in danger. And obviously, we know that, you know, it does take a beast of a person, really, to swim out into a lake and save someone who's drowning, because the chances are, you've heard it since you were a little kid,
mm-hmm.
if you try to save someone drowning, they'll usually drown you. Mm-hmm. Because they just use you for a buoy and pull you down while they try to keep themselves alive, especially yeah. if they're frantic. So, on that side of it, but the mocking part. And my idea in the whole thing was, okay, maybe they didn't aggress on this guy,
mm-hmm.
but could there be a higher law than just the non-aggression principle? Where, what about the golden rule? And these people's comments are all about, you know, well, in a private property society, would we obligate them to blah, blah? Maybe not. But on the other side of it, if you have your society that, you know, in our idea of a private property society, you live where you want to live.
Mm-hmm.
You choose the people you live with. If they have a set of rules, if they're a socialist community voluntarily and you want to be a part of that, go for it.
Right.
If they're a fascist community voluntarily and you want to be, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So, But what sort of voluntarist society would you really want to be in? And I think more so of a society that followed the golden rule, which is basically do unto others as you would have them do to you.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe these kids don't want to drown. They don't. But all of them had cell phones. They had time to film the guy drowning.
Right. Well, yeah, and during the time that they were filming, they weren't looking for something that could have been, that would be floating, or a rope or something that they could use. They weren't looking to find some way to help the guy.
Right.
Even though they probably didn't know how. Instead, what they were probably doing, before jumping to that, I have to ask the question: Would an event like that happen in a free society?
Right.
I mean, one where the state isn't involved. And, you know, maybe it would, maybe it wouldn't. I would see it be far less likely. And the reason for that is that in a free society, individuals depend on each other. There's actually a need for empathy, a need to care about your neighbor, because your neighbor will care about you back. And mm-hmm. that's a mechanism for survival. And with the state getting involved and becoming the caretaker of every person. So I no longer need to depend on my neighbor. My neighbor doesn't need to depend on me. I can run to the state for my livelihood. They can run to the state for their livelihood. So now people are separate. And so the use of empathy has been driven out of people. It's no longer necessary. And so it's no longer part of the thinking process.
Well, and it can also be a detriment to your own self to have empathy for your fellow neighbor. Because, mm-hmm. like, state of Alaska, your neighbor in the wintertime drives off the road. I mean, how many people do we see that drive off the road in the wintertime or skid off the road, whatever?
I do. Right. I carry chains around to pull them out.
Yeah. Well, in that same manner, if you're caught by a policeman...
Yeah,
pulling someone out, you get mm-hmm. a ticket.
Right.
For being a good neighbor, mm-hmm. for following the golden rule. So really, being a good neighbor, following the golden rule, will get you in trouble mm-hmm. because of the state. Mm-hmm. And I think you have it exactly right, where the empathy part, where the state has made life, and I agree with you, I blame the state for it. I blame the state for just about everything.
Well, it's a legitimate blame.
Exactly. The state has made human life so worthless mm-hmm. that people can watch someone die and not give a lick about it.
Yeah.
Because they've been taught that from the time they started public school.
Yeah. And
it's just like what you were talking about with the... Well, I guess that's kind of a different subject, but...
Yeah, that's, but you know, that's kind of where I was getting was, you know, they go to public school and... In public school, it's just a cold environment. It's not a caring environment of any type whatsoever. It's just purely disciplinary and do what you're told, and it's purely about discipline and obedience, and that's it. Yeah, and so you know they spend their days there, and the result is the way to gain acceptance among your peers is to be the most callous. It's to be the leader. Yeah, and public schools teach that as well. Don't you want to aspire to be the leader? However empty that position of leader is. Well, be voted as the leader. Well, that's a pretty empty goal, isn't it? Just to be voted in. So what do you have to do to be voted in? You have to be the coolest, the most callous. Especially if you're in a bad part of town where the gangs proliferate because of the state involvement. But so these guys are internally, I would guess these were five guys, and each one of them was trying to prove to the other four that they're more callous than the other. Yeah. In reality, they're inside, they're thinking, I wonder if there's something we can do. I don't know how to help this guy. But they don't want to look like the idiot in the group. Yeah. So they're laughing while they're filming the guy, filming the guy drown. Yeah. And also that they can gain approval of the other four around them.
Well, you know, when you speak of the public school system, what is that ultimately is a prison setting of survival of the fittest.
Yes, public school is a prison.
Yeah, it's a primitive setting. I mean, goes. I mean, it's basically a dog-eat-dog, primitive setting, Stone Age setting is basically what they put these kids into, a survival of the fittest. Because you're told to obey, obey, obey. You're taught to obey, obey, obey. But there's no real protection from the other primates there from this authority figure or by this authority figure. Because otherwise there would be no such thing as school bullying.
Right.
There'd be no such thing as, you know, gangs in schools. There's all the bad stuff in schools. If these so-called authority figures, the school teachers, the cops that are there, the principals, whatever, if they were actually authorities that protected them, none of those things would happen. Right. But what they're taught is you will obey without question, but don't expect anything back.
Yeah.
And so they're brought up to be citizens, quote unquote, like that, to where, hey, survival of the fittest. I got mine, Jack. You know, I'm not going to reach out. I'm not going to stretch my neck out for you. Mm-hmm. You know, but another thing, too, think about this. So they call the cops. Well, cops shoot people.
Yeah.
Maybe they just read a story on CNN or something where they just saw that some mom called the cops to help her with their disabled son, retarded son, and I mean that in the literal sense, and the son gets shot, and the mom gets arrested. It's like, what? Well, maybe I don't want to call them, because I'll get shot and thrown in jail. But I mean, it is, I'm not making excuses for them, because they were mocking the guy, and that's just pretty sick.
Right.
But, you know, some of the comments, and one of the comments in particular on the Target Liberty story was someone said, well, you know, the parents and blah, blah, blah. Yeah, sure, the parents. First of all, and I'll blame the parents for letting them go to public school. Because that is where this mentality starts. That's where it's fostered. That's where it's bred. And that's where it's fed. That's where all this mentality starts, is at the public school.
Right. Ultimately, each of those people are a product of their environment. And their environment is, I have no doubt, made up largely of the state. Public school.
Whether it's through welfare, whether it's through the war on drugs, all these different factors.
Right. And you mentioned police. I mean, you and I have seen, I mean, there's countless videos of police, just absolute callousness. Choking, the famous one, choking a guy on the street. Well, I can't breathe. Well, you shouldn't have broken the law.
Well,
yeah, and they're told that the police are the best and the brightest.
Right.
You know, they're the ones to aspire to be like.
Well, I actually didn't read it. There was something on RT where some guy, chief of police, resigned because, I don't know, some cop shot some Australian lady.
Oh, I didn't know he resigned. Yeah, okay.
Chief of police resigned, I think.
Uh-huh. Okay.
I don't really know what the story is, though. Just some woman got shot.
To be honest, I'm not real familiar with. I'm not familiar with the details of the story, but it was
figured that one out at the top of the hour or something.
Yeah, it was an Australian lady who had just moved here, and she called the police because she thought she was witnessing an assault, and the police showed up and shot her. But I don't know. I don't really know the details of that.
So the major part of the story is just the way that these kids handled it. And you know what? Maybe they don't know any other way to handle it.
Right. I think what you're saying
might have been entertaining for them too.
Yeah.
Who knows? Why should they value life? What has been ingrained in them that values life? Certainly nothing from the state.
Right. Well, let's say let's imagine that one of them did know how to handle it. Okay. Would he have done what they did, or would he have done what he knew how to do? Because then he would have gained the acceptance of the others by knowing what to do, right? So that's what he would have wanted to do in front of them.
Yeah.
So I think that the fact that they were laughing and mocking him shows that none of them knew what they were doing.
Yeah, that's probably true. Well, on the other hand, too, in this society that we have where everyone gets a trophy, I mean, is there any such thing anymore as a heroic act? Mm-hmm. I mean, today, anyone that joins the military is a hero automatically because he signed that line. You know, anyone that, you know, the sports players are heroes. Mm-hmm. Just go on down the line. The subject of a quote-unquote hero is just about anything. So, yeah, if one of them had actually saved that guy, he would have done something heroic. But heroics have been dumbed down so far in this everyone gets a participation trophy. There's no winners. There's no losers. Mm-hmm. Who cares? Let the guy drown. Who cares? Yeah. And what reaction is going to happen to them? Big deal. They, if anything, they got in the news. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're big stuff. They're going to go to school and like, yeah, right. And their teachers, what can they say to them? But, oh, wow, you got on TV. Good job. You know, because is the teacher going to be able to go, you know what? You violated the golden rule. In a private property society, you would probably be shunned and told to leave that society. Mm-hmm. Or if you stayed in that society, no one would want to have anything to do with you. And I just imagine, you know, knowing you as well as I do, and you know me as well as you, you know, we know each other very well. The type of society if that we would join, that crap wouldn't stand. Not right. for a minute.
No.
Not for 1 minute. No. They wouldn't be going out to eat anywhere. They wouldn't be buying anything from any stores. They wouldn't be getting any gas for their car. Their phone service would get shut off. All down the line. Mm-hmm. You know, when people say, well, in your stupid utopian society, you know, if you don't have the cops and the state, how are we going to punish people? Public, the, and I don't mean that as a conglomerate, state public. Mm-hmm. The public, the community would punish them.
Just by their natural action.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And if there was some jackass that thought he's like, oh, yeah, well, I'm going to be the one outlier that, that does deal with these guys, well, then he gets ostracized.
Right. And that's a whole other discussion I think we could have later on is the idea of punishment. Why are people so fixated on the need for an artificial punishment and right. the need to have a state to do it?
Exactly. Exactly. The you know, we...
He needs to be punished.
By the state.
Define why.
That how does that fix the problem? Environment in the first place.
Yes. How does that fix the problem?
Right.
Punishment is not a time machine, is it?
No. And, yeah, I mean, is there, you know, is there any recourse for the person that was, you know, ultimately, were they obligated? So that's that's kind of the fun, except for the fact we're talking about someone's life, that's kind of the fun talk, you know. Were they obligated to help him? Maybe not. Mm-hmm. But they shouldn't have been filming themselves mocking and laughing at the guy.
Yeah, and I think as far as the libertarian / anarchist community goes, it's kind of an irrelevant conversation.
Yeah.
For the reasons that we've already discussed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because we aren't living in a free society.
No, we're not.
And there's no doubt. I mean, it's just like you look at the inner cities and look at Fairbanks, whatever. Mm-hmm. The problems that exist are probably premeditated, but they are designed by the state. Mm-hmm. There's just no doubt about it. I mean, I'll just take this. So the state says you can kill babies in the womb. Mm-hmm. Okay, no matter what your opinion is about it, whether you're pro-choice, pro-life, whatever, the state says it's okay.
And therefore it's okay.
Right. So that life means nothing. The state says it's okay to steal you from your parents when you're 17 years old and force you to kill or be killed in their wars. Mm-hmm. So your life means nothing there. The state says that you can fly a drone when you're in Virginia over some country in the Middle East and bomb a wedding and say, oh, shoot, there actually weren't any bad guys there. Mm-hmm. And you killed 23 little kids. Yeah. Well, you know what? That's okay. Their lives don't really mean anything.
Yeah.
So life itself is turned into nothingness, and it's the state itself that makes life worthless. Mm-hmm. We are worthless to the state.
Yeah. And you know, I've talked about this once before on the show, and that's a guy I met during the who was in jail. Mm-hmm. You know, this was when I was kidnapped and held hostage.
Yep.
But he was from I can't remember exactly what community it was, but he was from one of the northeast ghetto towns, and this was, you know, completely gangster ravaged place. This is where, you know, welfare proliferated, where the state proliferated, and the gangs, you know, copied what they saw. Mm-hmm. And he described how it was, how it became somewhat routine to go out and just find a dead body laying somewhere, and he became desensitized to it.
Right.
And so he was there on an assault charge, and so and for him, it was just a way of life. It was part of his programming.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he didn't know any different. Empathy had been driven out of him. He could bash someone over the head and not care. You know, he even said that. Mm-hmm. And you know, this is, and now take a look at what they do overseas. You're talking about the drone. You know, why do we have so many ISIS recruits? Well, when you have an entire generation of people who have witnessed nothing but death and destruction, who've come home to a pile of rubble to spine the body parts of their relatives strewn about their former house, what do you think you're going to produce?
Some angry young men.
You're right. You're going to produce an entire generation who have no programming outside that of death and destruction. And again, the state has deprogrammed empathy from them,
mm-hmm.
just as occurred with these kids in Florida.
Yeah, mentality-wise, what's the difference? There is none.
There is no difference.
There is really none. When you look at... No, you hit it on the button. You have a whole generation in the Middle East. Actually, you have a whole generation in America that's known nothing but war. All right. My kids, the oldest one's 23, but basically he's known nothing because, you know, when he was 4, 5, 6 years old, mm-hmm. he didn't remember anything about that. He's known nothing but war in America,
mm-hmm.
the war on terror. My younger kids, all your kids, mm-hmm. have known nothing but the United States at war,
mm-hmm.
and killing people. And, you know, we're safe, quote unquote, over here because, you know, how does it really affect our lives? It doesn't affect mm-hmm. us at all, you know, except it affects you and I because we're conscious of it.
Yeah.
And so it affects us that way. But, you know, for the normal Joe Blow, he can go throughout his days and not even know what that government that he pledges allegiance to when that little flag comes up is doing in his name every single stinking day.
Yeah.
And, you know, even, this is kind of an aside, but you know that even drone guys, people that are flying drones now are suffering from PTSD.
Yeah.
And several suicides lately.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and a lot of them left.
Yeah. And good for them.
Yeah.
Good for them for leaving. Because right. you can't disassociate human life. You shouldn't be able to disassociate human life. And the only ones that I've seen that can do that and proliferate through life and do well in life
mm-hmm.
are politicians and upper echelon military men
mm-hmm.
who are just wicked and evil.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I think also the reason the state wants these things, I mean, no doubt in my mind, the state thrives. Obviously, we know the state thrives on war, but I think it also thrives on the delegitimization of human life because it basically makes us all a bunch of drones. It makes us all a bunch of zombies.
Mm-hmm.
And how much easier is it to control zombies than it is a thinking community, with ethics, with maybe a little bit of morals?
Right. And you know, as we know, the capital of the state is not money. It's human flesh.
Exactly.
The conflict is the health of the state.
Well, think about
whether it's here or overseas.
Yeah, exactly. And what's the most dangerous anti-state thing that there is out there? It's family and community.
Mm-hmm.
The first thing they have to do is delegitimize a family because as long as they have family structure, that family that values life, the state can't control that.
Mm-hmm.
And you just about have to be dumb and blind to think that the United States government does not want to control every aspect of every human being's life on this planet. Not just Americans, on this planet.
Mm-hmm.
And the number one thing I really do think that stands in its way is the family unit. It has to destroy that. And the first way you do that is to devalue life itself.
Mm-hmm.
And they've been doing a darn good job. And you know what? What's the greatest political philosophy that does devalue life? It's communism.
Yeah, and of course its planks include public education.
Exactly. You have to have that.
You're right. Yeah, public school. You know, I remember, again, when I was in hostage keeping in Fairbanks, going out in the yard the first day, and I looked at the building,
mm-hmm.
you know, and I looked at the inside as well, and I realized it is built precisely like an elementary school. Its layout is identical. You have the front office, you have the nurse's office, you have the lobby, you have the classrooms, the dorms, right? You have the gym. Yeah. And then on the outside, the walls look the same. The windows look just like the 70s built elementary schools.
Yeah.
So it's an identical layout. And the public schools are training grounds for prisons. It's all about obedience. You know, go to your classroom when you're told. You have a certain amount of time for recess, and you can go out to the recess yard. And then you come in single file when you're told to.
Yep. It's and identical. You still get you still get to go through your metal detectors and your pat downs and all that good stuff. And go to public school.
I guess they do. Yeah, they have that in the public schools now, right?
Right. So. Absolutely. Well, yeah, we can't have those punk kids this way. Mm-hmm. Well, we got a couple calls. You want to take them?
Okay.
All right. Hello, caller. Thanks for holding. You're on the air.
Hey, how you doing?
Good.
All right. It is me. I don't know. I listen to you guys talk and think about something. I call in with a specific thing, and I listen to y'all guys talk and lose my train of thought because all the stuff I guess is really... I didn't hear. But I guess my train of thought turned to what y'all were talking about earlier about life not meaning anything unless it's something, unless you can produce something for the state.
Mm-hmm.
And goes back to that child in Great Britain. A death panel of doctors decided that this child's life has no meaning. They disguised that with, oh, it has no meaning to itself. In actuality, is what they're saying is a child's life has no meaning to the state. The child is just going to be a drain on the state. And this mentality that we have now, the U.S., the revolution in the United States back in 1776 was not a revolution. I mean, it was. There was guns. There was people fighting. But it was the culmination of evil. We went from a hunter-gatherer society that people went out, did the thing, did what they had to do. They contributed to the community. They helped each other out. They probably fought. You know, it's human nature. And then over eons, we evolved into this system where, all right, you were queefed out of a particular crotch, so you get to be in charge, and you get to own the land, and I get to rent the land. We call that property taxes now, but I get to rent the land, and I can live on that land as long as I'm producing for you. And as soon as I die, then you're going to take my wife and kids off unless they can take over the farm. And then we slowly started evolving with the once we started reading and more people were able to read and more people knew and books became available in the vernacular and they started reading Aristotle, they started reading Plato, they started reading Locke, they started reading all these other philosophers down through the years and we evolved to true nature. And one of those philosophers is Jesus. I mean, y'all might sense this, I don't know, but when I read the New Testament and I talked to Christians or other Christians, I always left one. Why aren't you a libertarian? Because Jesus said, you go into a town, you preach the word. If they reject it, you walk your feet, knock the dust off your boots, and go to the next town. You don't whip out your sword and force them to convert. It was all about the individual. Render unto Caesar what's Caesar's, right?
Mm-hmm.
But what he meant by that was, is don't worry about Caesar. Worry about yourself. The most important. I mean, you're more important than birds of the field.
Mm-hmm.
They don't starve. You get what I'm saying?
Yep.
Yeah.
So we evolved all these years to what we reap in 1776. Now we still had some evolving to do because things got a little crazy quite soon after. I mean, to be honest with you, you know, the argument that we had to get rid of the Articles of Confederation because they didn't work. Well, we just won a revolution. We, with help, yes, I understand, and not as much as history says, but with help, we defeated the largest empire on the planet. It's kind of like, really, an area twice the size of Judea,
mm-hmm.
with about the same amount of people, defeating the Roman Empire.
Yeah.
Yeah, and one of the biggest players in that were the privateers. The Parliament stopped the war because the privateers were taking their boats and bankrupting the British Empire.
Yeah, it's just it'd be akin to Afghanistan kicking the Soviets out of Afghanistan.
Yeah.
The Afghanistan beating the British Empire.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Afghanistan beating the U.S. Empire.
Yeah.
Afghanistan is just a bad place to go if you're an empire. Stay away. Learn from history, jackasses.
Oh, they're too egotistical.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's all of it. It's ego.
Yeah.
And my point is, and my curiosity, my fear, is how long would you know, when I read that story about those children or young adults, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Laughing and filming a guy drowning.
Yeah.
God, my English gets bad sometimes. But laughing at a guy who's drowning, and some of the things I heard them say, because I didn't watch the video, I just heard some of it on the radio, and I'm like, how long is it going to take, how many generations is it going to take that line of thinking?
Huh. Well, I think it behooves parents that know better to take extra precautions and pull your kids out of the freaking public school.
Well, the state's taken away from parents.
Yeah.
And the state's taken away their financial ability to put them in a private school. And then you still have the problem of the state, no matter what, private school or not, the state still kind of controls that private school to greater and lesser degrees. And that's good for them. What's really good for them is they control where the teachers learn to be teachers.
Yeah, that's why I think that we have to have, well, Fairbanks needs the Ron Paul Institute or the Ron Paul homeschool curriculum school, because the plan that I got in my mind would be totally decentralized. You wouldn't have quote unquote teachers. You would just be having get togethers, and it would totally get rid of any state influence. You wouldn't accept any money, of course. You wouldn't allow anyone to use state money to purchase the program. We would rely on the community folks that, let's just say listeners to the show or like-minded folks helping each other out you know, we're talking about $250 a year. So I think even, let's say we had 50 kids enroll. Well, I know some of the parents could afford to pay for that, and I'm sure there's enough people that would value that schooling, that teaching. I don't want to call it school. I mean, I hate the word school now because it's so loaded.
Yeah.
But the educationally, there's got to be enough people where we could bankroll 50 kids, bankroll 100 kids. And just imagine if you have 50 to 100 kids that go through this educational system that I've looked through the Ron Paul thing. My kids did it for only 1 year, but it's fabulous. And imagine having 50 to 100 young adults come into adulthood in this community that had it together, that had economics together, that had the idea of what the state is together, the idea of personal responsibility and liberty and all these things, that had the fundamentals, the values that the founding the colonial generation, not just the founding generation, but the colonials. You know, that's what we need to strive for, that, because they won that war because, for one thing, they valued the right to life. That's the first thing in the Declaration of Independence. All men have the right to life. And that means their own life. That means not being controlled by the state. This is my life.
It's a simple, the simplest way to put it, and I don't know where I read this. I don't know where I picked it up. I don't know if it's a conglomeration of things I've learned through my life. The simplest way to put it, if you have the right to do as you please, providing it doesn't deprive me or others of our right to life, liberty, or property through force or fraud.
Yeah.
It's not that difficult.
I think it was Jefferson said something, I'm paraphrasing, something to the effect of, my right ends at the end of your nose.
Yeah, exactly.
That's where it stops. You're
going to swing your fist in 1 inch from my nose.
Yeah. And if it gets that close, you might get popped.
Depends on the person's view of personal space.
Yep.
But, you know, one of the fights with the education, I mean, it's one thing to educate children, but one of the things, don't let them watch Disney.
Well, except for Star Wars, come on.
Oh, God, you know what I saw? My daughter was watching this thing last night on Disney, and I was kind of half interested in it. I hate musicals, especially musicals that use one of those, they can make me sound like an angel.
Oh, yeah, I know what you're saying.
Yeah.
All the new Disney movies. But come on, now wait a minute, I got to stop you right there. You hate musicals. You're not, I'm sure you're counting out The Sound of Music and Seven Brides for Seven Brothers.
Well, Paint Your Wagon.
Paint Your Wagon, exactly. So, yeah.
That's actually one of my favorite movies.
So don't paint them, quote unquote, all as a bad thing.
Okay.
Annie, Get Your Gun. What a great musical. Go ahead. Sorry.
Chitty Chitty Bang Bang.
Chitty Chitty Bang Bang.
I love that.
No matter what the commercial is for, it could be for, you know, paper towels, hemorrhoid cream. At the end of the commercial, the announcer, and it got annoying as well, but at the end of it, it said the Disney Channel or company proudly supports the Disney Channel. Now you would think, okay, what, right? But during the movie, during the show, there was this one scene, and I'll try to be as quick as possible. There's one scene where this girl was making a cloak for the prince, right?
Mm-hmm.
She was talking about how I'm going to put the stitching in the back, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, I'm going to do the other. It's going to be lovely, great, love it, it's going to be awesome. And right at the end, she says, oh, and on the fringe, I'm going to put, you know, fake fur. Okay. Maybe it's my way of thinking, or maybe it's because I understand propaganda. That's exactly what that was. It was propaganda, because what she was saying, you know, most people would just say, I'm going to put fur on the, and it could be fake, it could be real, whatever, you know. You wouldn't think it too
right.
two things about her, right? But because she said she's going to use fake fur, that's good because this is a beautiful cloak and you wouldn't want real fur on it. That's the inference.
Right. Mm-hmm. No, the I mean, Hollywood does propagandize, like, animal rights stuff, global warming stuff, and things like that. There's no doubt about it. And Disney's not immune from such things.
Yeah.
No doubt.
Well, did you hear what Bill Nye, the engineer guy, said?
Oh, Bill Nye, the non-science guy?
Well, he's actually an engineer. He's not a scientist. He's an engineer.
Right, right? That's true.
Bill Nye, the engineer guy. But he said that in order to do anything for global warming, that we're going to have to let the deniers age out.
Right.
Die, in other words.
Right.
Because, you know, we're propagandizing to the kids. They're down with this hook, line, and sinker, at least the majority of them.
Oh, yeah. In public school, that's exactly what they teach. It's a communist plot. There's no doubt about it.
Well,
it's a communist plot.
Yeah, and it's been presented over the years. I remember in 88 when I was in elementary school, and they were telling me that New York was going to be underwater by 2000 or 2010. I can't remember now. Yeah, yeah.
Fuck out of
and
line.
Darn it, it's still there.
Promised flying cars, New York would be underwater. Come on.
Yeah, Los Angeles is supposed to be swimming. Those jerks, they lied. Dang it.
Well, I don't know. I tell you what. I mean, I heard this when I was a kid, and I didn't really fully understand it. But, you know, I think what a terrible way for people to live nowadays. I mean, children are terrified.
Well, that's the point. Yeah, the state gives them things to be afraid of, just bogus things to be afraid
Absolutely.
Of, so the state can come along and save them.
You got to have a savior. Exactly. You have to. The state exists by having a constant state of fear mm-hmm. with its people.
Right.
You have to have a state of fear with the people at all times, because when people feel secure, what do they don't need? The state.
Yeah.
Exactly.
And, you know, and that, you know, speaking of movies, just throw this in, the Lion King, remember that won all sorts of awards. Right.
Uh-huh.
And then I hadn't seen it until about 3 years ago. And to be honest, I was disgusted. It was the movie is everyone's living in paradise because they have a great king. And then the bad king comes in. They're all living in utter poverty. And then they're all saved when the great king comes back. And they're all cheering as the great king raises his newborn son, who's going to be their new master. It's a terrible piece of propaganda. I was just disgusted with the movie when I saw it.
The greatest Disney cartoon is obviously Robin Hood. I love that one beyond any of them. All the new ones pretty much suck. But Robin Hood's good. Even Peter Pan has some qualities to it.
Mm-hmm.
But, The Lion King, I don't even remember. I remember that thing where they raised the kid up, but yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, but I mean, the scenes where the good king's in power, and everyone's prosperous because they have the good master,
mm-hmm.
and then the bad king comes in power, and everyone's in poverty, and then the good king comes back, and everyone's in prosperity again. So their prosperity and poverty doesn't depend on markets.
Right.
It depends solely on who's ruling their lives.
The good nature of the king.
Right.
You know, that puts me in mind of something that always just irritates the ever-living life out of me. If you want to just really get underneath my skin and ruin my day, just say Robin Hood stole from the rich and gave to the poor. Because he did not. He took from an unjust government that was illegitimate, and that was taxing the poor, you know, unjustly.
Mm-hmm.
He took that money back away from the sheriff. The sheriff was a part of the government, and gave it back to the people who paid the tax.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
In that story, you have the evolution, the idea that there is unjust tax, and there are unjust governments.
Yep.
The only problem is, at the end of the story, another king comes along and he takes over. He's a good king, even though he's been off doing something else, God knows what.
Well, he was off fighting the Crusades, and we all know we got to kill the Muslims.
Well, it's actually a really, really old, it's actually a much older story than that. It's passed down, and the reason for the good king for being gone has changed, as it's kind of like Beowulf. Beowulf, really old story.
Right.
So is Robin. But
you know, even that the Prince John in that is actually a historical figure, because that's where the Magna Charta came from. Real Prince John.
Mm-hmm. Yep. The story that you know most of us are used to. Who knows what the story is in school now?
Yeah.
Probably Robin Hood is stealing from.
No, the rich corporations.
Yeah. Giving to the poor.
Yeah. He steals from the rich corporations and gives it to the government so the government can dole out the necessary goods to all the poor folks, evenly. I'm surprised they haven't come up with that one yet. Give them some time.
Yeah.
Oh, good God, we're probably giving them an idea. Somewhere.
Yeah, that's one bad thing about this show. Sometimes we give them the wrong ideas. Like, oh no, should we have said that?
Yes.
All right.
I'm kind of done with my break. I need to get back to work.
All righty, sir. Well, thank you very much for the call. It's good. Thanks.
Later.
Appreciate it. Hello, caller. Thanks for holding.
Hello?
Yeah, yep. Go ahead. We got you.
Okay. Yeah, this is Carl, huh? Yeah, when you were talking earlier, and he kind of touched on some similarities to what I was thinking of, and what you brought up was akin to what really controls people, and we know it's the money, but who controls the money? The Federal Reserve. And how does the Federal Reserve work? That is the thing to truly understand, because when you got the head bankers of the Federal Reserve, controlling banks in that area and putting forth candidates and for public office and producing public laws, you're going to have these politicians passing laws to enrich these various Federal Reserve franchises across the country. Mm-hmm. So that's the before the Federal Reserve, it was interesting. There was local money supplies and different local banks that weren't controlled by the Federal Reserve. The trade off, the positive for the Federal Reserve, I see that for increased commerce, like international commerce and stuff like that. But still, there's some problems with the way the Federal Reserve is run, and people do not know about it. They do not know, when they go to school, public schools here, it's they're being taught and raised to support Federal Reserve bankers, because they're taught to worship these political candidates, which they support, which may, in fact, own the franchise, or at least a share in the franchise of the Federal Reserve. So people have, been bashing the Federal Reserve, and I'm like, wait a minute, it's a good thing. But I can see the bad part of the Federal Reserve, and that's why you have cops who are paid to rob from people in communities. Yep. It's even better to hire someone from outside the community to rob from people in different communities or different races. You see, white cops beating up black people, and then you see black people beating up the white cops.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Carl, we got to get to the break, man. Thanks for the call.
All right.
Appreciate
Take
it.
Take care.
Robin Hood and Little John walking through the forest, laughing back and forth at what the other has to say.
This actually used to be our opening song forever.
Yeah. Reminiscing this and that and having such a good time. Oodle-lolly, oodle-lolly, golly, what a day. Never ever thinking there was danger in the water they were drinking, they just guzzled it down. Never dreaming that a scheming sheriff and his posse was watching them and gathering around. Robin Hood and Little John running through the forest, jumping fences, dodging trees, and trying to get away. Contemplating nothing but escaping, finally making it. Oodle-lolly, oodle-lolly, golly, what a day. Robin Hood and Little John walking through the forest, laughing back and forth at what the other has to say. Reminiscing this and that and having such a good time. Oodle-lolly, oodle-lolly, golly, what a day. Never ever thinking there was danger in the water they were drinking, they just guzzled it down. Never dreaming that a scheming sheriff and his posse was watching them and gathering around. Robin Hood and Little John running through the forest, jumping fences, dodging trees, and trying to get away. Contemplating nothing but escaping, finally making it. Oodle-lolly, oodle-lolly, golly, what a day. Oodle-lolly, oodle-lolly, golly, what a day.
This is Patriot's Lament. We'll see you right after the break.
38th President was officially added to the Navy's fleet.
I hereby place United States ship Gerald R. Ford in commission.
The president called on Congress to do its job and approve higher military spending. A Made in the USA sign greeted guests as they boarded the state-of-the-art ship. President Trump said it was American steel and American hands that built the USS Ford.
Fox's Rachel Sutherland at Naval Base Norfolk. The president firing off a series of tweets this morning, one accusing the New York Times of leaking information on the whereabouts of ISIS leader Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi in 2015. The Times issuing a statement reading in part that no senior American officials complained publicly about the report until now. In the weekly addresses, President Trump highlighting his Made in America initiative while Democrats continue to push against Republican health care plans.
President Trump says it's time to stop allowing other countries to steal our jobs and drain our wealth.
We believe that our country is stronger, safer, and more prosperous when we make more of our goods and our products right here in the USA.
His weekly address focusing on what he calls two simple but crucial rules, Buy American and Hire American. Democrats, in their response, are attacking GOP efforts to pass a bill to repeal and replace Obamacare.
Trump care isn't a health care bill, because what health care bill leaves families paying more and kicks tens of millions of people off of coverage?
Senator Patty Murray of Washington State.
Fox's Pam Puso, Fox News, fair and balanced.
This is a test to find out if you know it all when it comes to children. Time starts now.
No thanks.
Every town has its ups and downs. Some towns' ups outnumber the downs. But not in Nottingham.
Not in Fairbanks.
I'm inclined to believe if we weren't so down, we'd up and leave.
Oh, we gotta interrupt here. We gotta take a guess, Mike, because he's only got a couple minutes to be with us. Hello.
Hi, Joshua.
Yes, Adam. How you doing, sir?
Hey, good. How are you doing?
Good. Thanks for calling in. Appreciate it. And just for everyone to know, this is Adam Dick from the Ron Paul Institute for Peace and Prosperity, who we haven't been able to hear from for a while, but I know you're a busy man, so we just got you for a few minutes, so hit it. Take it. It's all yours.
Hey, I just I just wanted to, one thing I wanted to make sure you knew about was the Institute is having its annual conference, second annual, on September 9th. That's Saturday, September 9th. And we'll be back at the same place as last time, which is the Washington Dulles Airport Marriott Hotel, right there by the Dulles Airport with a free shuttle. And we have great room rates, and it's going to be a lot of fun. Dr. Paul, Ron Paul, who's the chairman of the Institute, will be speaking. And Lou Rockwell, the founder of the Mises Institute and the publisher of LouRockwell.com, will also be speaking. And we'll be announcing more speakers as time goes on. But I just wanted to give everybody a heads up so that if they're able to make it out there, they're able to book their trip and get good room rates.
I'm going to have to talk to Dr. Paul about having this during moose season. That's getting kind of irritating.
Sorry about that. Is it again? We need to move it. What, we need to move it back a week or forward a week.
How? Either way, the 1st of September to the 20th of September is sacred here.
Oh, really? Okay. Well, I don't know if we can get you to come out. We might save a couple mooses, right?
Yeah, so. That's true. Yeah, we don't want to do that though. No, I'm just joking. Not really, but no, go ahead. So the tickets went on sale today, correct? Or yesterday?
This week. This okay. week, maybe on Wednesday. Yeah.
Do you know how much? Where do they go to get a ticket if folks want to go? And then
Guys
have, I think you guys have deals for the motel there and all this stuff?
Absolutely. And it's a nice hotel, very nice place, a big hotel right by the Dulles Airport. And this is in Washington, D.C. area where hotels tend to be quite expensive. But we've worked out a very good rate for the area, which is $89 a night.
Wow.
And, yeah, very good. I mean, you'll stay in a lot of small towns where you wouldn't expect it, and rooms will be more expensive than that at a hotel of this type. So, and the conference tickets can be obtained at ronpaulinstitute.org/conference. ronpaulinstitute.org/conference. And I believe right now there's an article up on the homepage about it too.
Yeah, it's a good one. Yep. Absolutely. Yeah, that's really exciting. You guys had from all accounts, it sounds like very successful last year. I thought it was pretty sweet that C-SPAN covered the whole thing. Have you guys talked to them at all this year about it?
Well, we'll be talking to them. The deal with C-SPAN is you never know until like day or two before at the earliest.
Hmm.
And we found out the day before, literally. And you know, we had the hotel people scurrying around to make sure they could accommodate everything.
Wow!
But they did come and they filmed the entire conference last time. But we'll have to see if it happens this time as well.
That's some planning ahead.
Yeah, and we'll be sure to have some other great speakers. Last year we had Lawrence Wilkerson, who was Colin Powell's chief of staff.
Yep.
Who's been very critical of all the wars in the Middle East and Afghanistan and how they've been operating. We had a great libertarian, Jacob Hornberger, who's runs the Future of Freedom Foundation. And plenty of other great speakers, and I'm sure we'll have a similar lineup this year.
Yeah, and those guys have been on fire just this year since the Donald has taken office. I mean, they've been. I mean, Wilkerson. I think he's been. Oh, I got to check my timeline here, but he's had a few good articles, and I think he's been on the Ron Paul Liberty Report too. Recently, as in since the last conference.
Mm-hmm.
And I really enjoy him because he was like the inside dude over the Iraq war. And it's just interesting to actually hear someone tell the truth about it for once.
Yeah, he's been there. He knows the inside story of how they manipulated Colin Powell into giving that notorious speech at the United Nations to justify the war based on ideas, including that Iraq had weapons of mass destruction. And, you know, Colin Powell's regretted that since, you know, he said it's one of the worst choices and things he's done. But that's what happens. You know, it's these intelligence agencies often and the high up, pro-war advisors are about pushing war. You know, they're not about finding the real information and using that to make decisions in the interest of national security or defense. They're about pushing an agenda, and that agenda often is war.
You know, I'm sorry. I was going to say, I remember when Colin Powell, I remember watching him, I think live when all that went down. Mm-hmm. And I actually, I think I just read his book. I think he had a book out by then about his coming up, you know, his life journey or whatever. And
sure.
I actually was one person that actually trusted Colin Powell because mm-hmm. it didn't seem like he was just a run-of-the-mill, you know, military politician.
You know what, he wasn't.
Yeah.
He wasn't, and that's why he's regretted it. He's not one of the people who stood by it, you know, at least for, you know, for 5 or 10 years, some of them, you know, by now it's become so utterly obvious that it was the wrong choice that
right.
that people will recant. But he wasn't your run of the mill military guy. He's, you know, but you know, look at people now like Mattis, who was high up at General Dynamics after he left the military. it's a revolving door, and I talk about that in the new 5 minutes, 5 issues that went out last night. A guy has taken a chief of staff position at at ICE, Immigration and Customs Enforcement, who was involved in creating the security protocols and such for the Transportation Security Administration back after the attacks of September 11th, and mm-hmm. then spent over a decade working for companies including Taser, you know, that makes the shock weapons, and companies that do facial recognition and baggage search technology as well. Now he's coming back to be chief of staff at ICE. You know, that's the revolving door. That's the, you know, the military industrial complex, and in this case, the new border industrial complex.
Right.
That generates huge profits out of, you know, keeping the fear alive and keeping the wars going and keeping the building of the militarization of police, you know, right on track.
So I assume that is mostly what the conference is going to be about. Is, well, can you just give us your take on what the conference will be? Obviously the focus is...
I can tell you that some of the focus is going to be on whistleblowers, which
really?
Is something that Dr. Paul has been very interested over the past couple of years in particular. Recently on his Ron Paul Liberty Report, he's had interviews with Edward Snowden and with Julian Assange and also with other whistleblowers, Kiriakou, Peter Van Doren. So we're going to have some whistleblowers at the conference. Can't give you any more details than that.
That's fine.
but Dr. Paul's been talking to some of the more prominent, well-known ones that have revealed some very significant information. And we will have whistleblowers at the conference, you know, giving their take on things. And you know, I'm seeing stuff now. You know, Pompeo, the CIA head, is. You know, he's speaking of WikiLeaks in a manner where if Julian Assange doesn't have safety in the Ecuadorian embassy, and that was an issue because there was a close presidential race in Ecuador, and the person who came in a rather close second wanted to give Julian Assange up, you know, kick him out of the embassy.
Hmm.
And if you kick him out of the embassy, you know, ever since he's been there, there have been, you know, London or British cops, you know, right out there on the sidewalk and street. So he'll get nabbed as soon as he's out of there. You know, Britain's the best buddy of the United States. Donald Trump and Theresa May get along just fine. He'll be on a plane over to who knows where, but maybe Guantanamo, because the way they're talking about it, WikiLeaks is a non-state actor, you know, threatening entity. You know, puts it right in a category similar to what Al Qaeda or ISIS would be. His situation is dire if he ever ends up on that sidewalk in front of the embassy.
Yeah. Wow. That's just unbelievable. wow. Well, that's pretty exciting. I'm looking forward to, I hope that C-SPAN shows up so we can actually watch it live. Well,
sure.
Unless I'm at Moose Camp, then that's not going to happen. But either way, yeah, it was really good. I was really excited about the way last year went. I know you guys were, sounded like Dr. Paul, who's the one we want to feel that way. Sounds like he was really energized by the whole outcome of last year's event.
Oh, absolutely. And he's excited about having a second conference. And it's a great opportunity to see him. You know, everybody wants to see him, but I know last year he was able to make some time to sign people's books and have some photos taken. And, of course, he gave a great speech, and he will this time too, I'm sure.
Don't doubt it. Oh, crap. I want to go again. Well, maybe I'll make it to the Mises 35th anniversary, because I think he's going to be there speaking too.
That's right. That's yeah. Right. He will. And, you know, next year we have to talk with you. We got to arrange this so you can.
We Alaskans want to come too, darn it. But we got to fill our freezers.
I know. Well, maybe there's a vegetarian Alaskan or two that'll come.
Do they make those? I don't know. I don't know if there are any. No, I'm sure there are somewhere. They're just not my friends. That's great. So what else? What have you been up to? I mean, obviously, I know this has got to be a lot of work for you guys, but anything on the side? I know you're still doing the 5 minutes, five issues, and any other thing you'd like to hit us with before you have to run?
Well, one thing I've it keeps coming up is Rodrigo Duterte over in the Philippines.
Oh yeah.
You know?
Wow.
He's a president over there, and he's kind of a Trump like guy, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Trump is run on this law and order ticket, and Duterte's the same way. And Duterte's taken it pretty far. And what I first was writing about with him months back, I guess it might have been last summer, was when he first came in, he declared a really ruthless war on drugs. Now one of the first things that Donald Trump said when he became president, he gave a speech, I believe it was to a bunch of police or prosecutors, I can't remember which, in D.C., and he promised a ruthless war on drugs. And, you know, Attorney General Sessions is coming through with that to a degree. But Duterte has really delivered on it, and many people have been killed. He's basically told the cops, as well as vigilante types, that they're free to kill people who are drug dealers or drug users.
Ugh.
And you're having these extrajudicial basic executions of people. And
he'll eat their livers.
Yeah, and I think he's talking about the Al-Qaeda type on that one, wasn't he? But yeah.
Oh, it might have been.
But yeah, he has some exotic talking. But the latest thing he did was he was attacked by James McGovern, in a way, who's a representative from Massachusetts. And McGovern had been at, I wrote about this, I didn't get into this aspect of it, but he'd been at a group, I think it's called the Tom Lantos Human Rights Commission, I believe it's called. And Tom Lantos was a member of the House of Representatives, died a few years back, who had a high-ranking position in the Foreign Affairs Committee. And, you know, major uber interventionist, you know, United States needs to be involved all over the world. And it was this kind of humanitarian intervention stuff.
Right.
Where we need to go over there. We need to sanction people. We need to kill people. We need to interfere with elections in order to be humanitarian. You know, the kind of thing that happened in Libya and was an absolute disaster for anybody who really wants to advance humanitarian causes. Well, that's the name of the group. It's named after him. And they were having a meeting about Duterte, and legitimately, you know, they're right that what he's doing with the drug war there is pretty awful. But Duterte came back, and in response to a comment by McGovern, McGovern was saying that that he would oppose and protest Duterte coming over to the U.S. to meet with Donald Trump, because Trump has invited him over to the White House.
Mm-hmm.
Now, a month or two ago, when that happened, the invitation, I commented that that was a great idea. You know, that it's good generally for Trump to meet with all these people. It can be a path to peace and prevent tensions. I think we've seen that some with him meeting at the G20 with President Putin. You know, I also advised that potentially, in the case of Duterte, it could go the other way, though, because the U.S. has military relations with the Philippines. It seems like Duterte, in attacking Obama previously, rather colorfully, was actually trying to feint that he was going to move towards China. And, you know, the U.S. wants to keep the military connection. So I think it's kind of a bluff to try to get more money out of the U.S. And of all things, the U.S. has been funding the drug war in the Philippines as well, even while these Congress members and the Obama administration was criticizing it. The money was flowing to the cops in the Philippines and was being used in support of the drug war. But he responded to McGovern saying that America's a lousy country, and for the rest of my term and the rest of my life, I'm never going there again. And he pointed out that instead of you know, criticizing what's going on in the Philippines, the first thing that the Congress in America should do is to investigate all the people it's killed in the Middle East. And, you know, it's a biting and true criticism. And, you know, it demonstrates the wisdom of the aphorism that people in glass houses shouldn't throw stones. Because, you know, U.S. government has a history of wars, you know. Go back to Vietnam, Korea, and now all these wars in the Middle East, Afghanistan, covert operations, drones, commando raids, where so many people are killed and hurt, plus sanctions against Cuba or Iran or Russia that inflict, you know, in some cases inflict death because people are deprived of medicine and food, you know. In the extreme case, Yemen, where the U.S. is not directly doing it, but it's supporting Saudi Arabia. It's providing the technology, it's providing the support, it's providing the refueling of the airplanes that are doing the bombing. And that has resulted in people lacking food and medicine. And there's a cholera outbreak that is killing many people.
Thousands of people have cholera, and
it arises from the U.S., Saudi, and allied effort against that country. So hopefully from what Duterte said, you know, some people will see that it resonates. They'll say, hey, you know, he's got a point there. And maybe his comments will help people discover the non-interventionist position that was so prevalent in the early days of America that President George W. George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, John Quincy Adams talked eloquently about.
Yep, absolutely. Yeah, boy. Well, that was a lot. That was pretty good for just being on here for 15 minutes, Adam.
I'm glad to be on the show. I'm sorry I'm tied up with things, but...
Hey, it's for a good cause.
So, yeah. I just want to tell people about the conference and talk a little. It's been a while.
Yes.
And hopefully in August, maybe in 3 weeks or so, we can have a more extended conversation. I can take some calls. I love to do that.
Yeah, I love it too. It's really fun. All right, man. Well, thanks again for just, I know you're really super busy, so thanks for at least giving us a little bit of time. And folks, get on the Ron Paul Institute website and check it out. And if you can, plan on being there on the 9th of September because it's going to be awesome. No doubt about it. All right, Adam, I guess if you want to close with anything or We'll let you get back to your job.
That's the main thing. I'll just get back to conference. Direct link is ronpaulinstitute.org/conference. And people can find the writing I do and my audio show at ronpaulinstitute.org. And they can also see those things at adamdick.com. And there they can also find my Facebook and Twitter.
Right on. Well, get back to work. I don't want Dr. Paul or Daniel to write me a nasty gram saying, hey, this guy's supposed to be working today.
All right. I'll do that.
All right. Take care, my friend, and be safe. Too. Looking forward to talking to you again.
Sounds great.
Hey,
bye.
Bye. That was Adam Dick from the Ron Paul Institute for Peace and Prosperity. And we're going to take a small break and be right back to you with another surprise guest.
I'm up north. Gotta burn my boots. They touched Yankee soil. Lay down your arms and step forward, Yankee.
What's the hassle, Schmassel?
My orders from General Lee is to hold the Macy-Dixie line, and no Yankees are crossing it.
General Lee? Why, the war between the states ended almost 90 years ago.
I'm no clock watcher. And until I hears from General Lee official, I'm a blasting any Yankee that sets foot on southern soil. So scram, Yankee!
All right, we're back. It's just a little clip from Bugs Bunny. Southern Bugs.
One of our boys.
Oh, wait,
the
I gotta watch.
The sun shines bright in my old Kentucky home.
I think they banned these commercials.
Hey there, boy. How about giving out with something peppy on that there skin box, huh?
Yeah, over. Yankee Doodle went to town riding on a pony.
Yankee Doodle!
Stuck a carrot in his hat and called it the carrot.
You traitor!
Don't beat me, massa! Please don't.
You know, one of the things about this thing, though, is this whole thing with the...
What's this I hear about you whipping slaves? But, never mind the butts. Here's my card. Look me up at my Gettysburg address.
This whole thing with the South and the Confederacy and everything still isn't gone.
Right.
Right? They're still trying to get rid of... I don't think anyone's trying to get rid of this cartoon, thankfully, but they're still trying to get rid of the statues and the memorials and the... You know, what a bunch of crap. Okay. Leave it alone. Anyways, all right. Welcome back to Patriot Cement. We have a very... special guest, very interesting guest. One of the original godless monkeys of the Patriot Cement Show, Mr. David Geisel. How's it going, man?
It's going pretty good, Josh.
Good to see you. Good to hear you on air, in studio. Actually.
In studio, in yeah. Studio. Exciting.
So what's, you used to live in this dredgy hole and moved on to better things. I remember when, let's see. I can vividly remember back at the other studio when we were talking about expatriating or whatever, and some jackhole called up, and he's like, oh, yeah, you guys are talking. Well, why don't you leave? And you said, well, actually, I am. This is the last day on the show for me. And the next week, you left the country. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, better places, I don't know if I would say that. Certainly different. Mm-hmm. Like, better in some ways, worse than others.
Sure.
Which has been fun, and I actually am of the opinion that the whole if you don't like it you should leave. I remember us doing a lot of battle on the radio with people on that. Yeah. I think they were totally right. It's a lot easier than swimming upstream, but don't expect to find, you know, the perfect place or whatever, because that doesn't exist.
Right. There's states everywhere you go.
Yeah, there's states everywhere you go, and you get to pick. It's kind of like. Josh Luther.
Yeah.
He's really into dogs and he talks about dog breeding a bunch. And you can breed for traits that you want, but you will get other traits whether you want them or not. Right?
Hmm.
You pick for something, but you don't get it for free. So like purebred dogs, a lot of them are really intelligent, or they have soft jaws, you know, like bird dogs and stuff. But then they have, you know, hip dysplasia, or they have some susceptibility to a disease or whatever. So
cancer.
Or cancer, yeah. So you pick your, you got to decide what you want and what you don't want, and then choose accordingly. And So that's been fun. It's been fun to do that and not be thinking that there's some paradise, but instead, you know, just going someplace different and enjoying the things about it that are there to enjoy, and getting an outside perspective and appreciating the things on about America that there are to appreciate. So,
so did you actually find some of those?
Yeah. America is a great place to do business. It is probably, I don't know if it's the best. It's a very good place to make money and do business.
Now, I want to expand on that just because, you know, that might be easy for someone, you know, oh, yeah, well, where else have you been? But you've been all over the world.
Yeah, I got my passport here because that comes with me regularly now. So we have, there's the boring ones. There's Canada, where I live now. Then there's Ecuador. There's Jordan, Korea, Japan. There's three, there's China. There's a couple. There's the 10-year Chinese visa. Here's three Iraqi one-time entry visas. 1, 2, 3. So, and then a bunch of places in between. There's France and Switzerland, the Netherlands.
So you've knocked around the world and got to see different.
Yeah, the job that I moved to, the whole deal was, it was like a remote field job. Mm-hmm. And so most, I don't know, 30%, 40% of the time I was on the road. And sometimes for like 2 or 3 weeks, like you get to spend almost a month somewhere and then you go back. I went to Iraq 3 times. I spent a total of like 2 months there with no, I didn't, there were no other Americans there with me. I was there with Iraqi, ICTF, Iraqi Counterterrorism Forces. And an interpreter from Jordan. So, and actually, I will say that those guys are amazing. Those were some of my favorite guys who I've met in the last 5 years. They're really great guys. And it's a really amazing place. And the food is fantastic, and it's a shame what's happened to it. But it has its own things that are amazing, and it has its own stuff that's a major bummer. And the bummer stuff is really apparent, and you wouldn't understand what to appreciate. It would be difficult to see the things to appreciate about that place unless you were there. Huh. And you appreciate certain things about the U.S. when you're there too. You're like, oh man, be nice to not see like burned out car bomb cars on the side of the road.
Right,
like that'd be nice.
Well, thankfully, the United States is not in the business of bombing its own country yet.
Yeah, there is that. So,
but, I mean, give it time.
Yeah, you never know. but there are things definitely to appreciate about the States. But there are also things, most of my time has been in Canada, which is not that different at first glance, but it really is a different culture. Like, it is not nearly as politicized. So people think very politically because they're Westerners and they're white. So they're obsessed with politics, but not in the same way as Americans are. It's in a different way. It's a different flavor. I've actually enjoyed that. This last election, it was totally optional for me to have an opinion about people running for president. Which was amazing. So I didn't have one. I still don't. I don't have an opinion about the president of the United States anymore. And it is only when I am in the U.S. that I have to actively combat people who are trying to figure out what my take on it is.
Right.
Because I've decided not to have a take on it. It's not relevant to my daily life.
Well, it's easier just to hate all of them anyways.
That's true. Yeah, that is true. You can throw them all in the basket there.
Yep. It's just, equal opportunity hater.
Yeah.
Politicians.
Yeah. That was in Ecuador. It was fun. There was an election going on when I was there for the president. And one of the easy buttons for presidential candidates there is to talk about how they stand up to the U.S. That's like a big rallying cry for voting. And of course, you know, you got Julian Assange in the Ecuadorian embassy in London. And there's a couple other things that they've done as well. Somewhat ironically, they use U.S. dollars there as the currency. That's the national currency, so whatever. Very easy to travel there, though. No exchange rate stuff. But I was asking the guy who I was there with, he was a surveying guy. We were doing some surveying in the jungle for environmental stuff. And I was like, what's the deal with the election? He's like, they're all corrupt. You know, like the kids will pick somebody. Like this guy was in his mid-30s. He didn't really participate anymore. He's like, the kids care a lot. You know, they wave the signs. They do the parades. They'll pick somebody who promises them what they want. And then the guy will break the promise because he's a politician and he's corrupt. And then they'll be upset. And then they'll pick another guy. And for him, it was just background noise.
Yeah.
And that was not uncommon for older people there, like people in their late 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, and so on. It was just like, yeah, politicians are corrupt, but people really want them. And so we're going to let the kids, you know, these fiery Latin American kids pick them and have their hearts broken. And then when they're 35, they won't participate anymore either. And so,
you know, that's interesting about America to contrast it is that it seems like the older you get, the older people get here, the more they want politicians.
I mean,
how many, I mean, when you look at it, it's the younger generations, or we hope, that are losing their faith in the so-called system, and the older ones that are just like, no, we got to vote. I mean, we still get the old codgers that, what do you mean you guys don't vote? You got to have a president.
Yeah, well, you know, the social welfare state, right? Yeah. It's working for the old people, but it's not working so well for the younger people.
No, it's not. And I'd say younger people count as 43.
It ain't working.
Right. It ain't working.
You know, but on the other hand, it is a fantastic place to do business. Yeah. There are so many ways to shovel money around legally that you're actually encouraged to do when you're running a business that you really, like, taxes are only relevant to you if you decide not to run a business, really, which is not true in much of the world. And so if you structure your life for corporatism, America's a pretty good gig. If you just kind of like seed the fact, okay, you know, this isn't some utopia as described in the Declaration of Independence. You know, when Wolf Davoon was on the show, he talked about the Massachusetts Bay Company, right? And the Boston Tea Party really being a corporate revolt against paying the king. And the king owned the company, right?
Right.
So, you know, he identified that corporatism was kind of the thing that started the Revolutionary War in a way, right? There was obviously a big independent individualist sentiment, you know, with the Jeffersonians and stuff. But corporatism was there with the Massachusetts Bay Company and with, you know, the Hamiltons and whatnot, right? Yeah. So understanding...
Hancock was a big black market dude. Mm-hmm. I mean, there was plenty of reasons for him to want to fight and not want to fight at the same time.
Sure, right. You can make money either way. You can make money when the market's going up or down. But instead of this is actually a thing from neurolinguistics as well, Richard Bandler and John Grinder. If your model of reality is not working for you, it's an invitation to adjust your model of reality.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you can adjust the model of reality of America to be, you know, away from this idea that it's this place with you know, unparalleled freedom in all regards, mm-hmm. and you can instead adjust it to one that's, you know, it's a place with unparalleled freedom in business for sure,
right?
Along with some really great individual freedoms, like gun rights. Gun rights aren't better anywhere else in the world than they are here,
right.
Legally. You know, in practice, a lot of places in the world they're just not enforced, but gun laws aren't enforced, but. There's a handful of things in the States that are great. Business is one of them. And if you can operate as a corporatist and, you know, put your little corporatist badge on, it's great. You can knock it out of the park here. As you know.
Yep.
But if you, you know, there's the libertarian vow of poverty that we've talked about before, right?
Right.
If you decide to put on the, you know, America's the libertarian utopia, people just don't realize it yet, hat. You're swimming upstream, and you're swimming upstream from, like, the Revolutionary War onward.
Right.
So it's been fun to be out and appreciate how good it is to do business here, and also that other things, certain other aspects of life in other places are actually better. But it doesn't come for free. You do give up some things.
That's why we need our island, Dave.
The island will be amazing. Yes. And you know what? The island will be amazing for us.
Yep.
And it won't be amazing for a lot of people.
Yep.
The trade-offs will be.
I don't mind that.
Exactly. Right. Right. You pick your poison, which is the idea of states. You know, that was the whole idea of states, and it's still actually true to some extent. We moved. I have a company with my business partner Brian, and he was kind of marooned in California for almost 2 decades, which was killing him inside. And we bogeyed. Our company's in Idaho now.
Yeah.
And I kind of work remote and operate from Canada most of the time still, but our company is in Idaho instead of California, and it's a tremendous difference. Like, it's still inside the United States, but the corporate structure is a little bit different. The laws are different. We're making some weapons parts, and it's a way more friendly environment for that, just socially. Like, we can tell people what we do for a living. And
you're not shunned.
Yeah, and actually, legally, it's been great, too, because there are less people in Idaho than there are in, like, Santa Clara County.
Right.
Which is, we were in Santa Cruz County in California, which also has a bunch of people. So if you get hooked up in the community and you hire some local people and you have a local attorney and accountant, chances are you know people in the local government, you know the local judges and all this stuff. So if you have legal proceedings as a business and you've changed, the jurisdiction for the legal proceedings is in Idaho and you're an Idaho corporation, they're going to defend you.
Right.
Like, the state officials will actually fight for you there. Not true in California, largely, or in New York. Mm-hmm. You know, or any of these, you know, if you're anonymous, they have no reason to be interested in you. But if you employ their nephew or something and you have a relationship with them, then you get some real community stuff, which is the intent of states in the first place, I guess.
Yeah, I think that it actually is a good, it's a positive thing for the right to secede, right? So, or let's take that word out, the right to associate with whom you want.
Yeah, yeah. Freedom of association.
Freedom of association. I mean, we luckily still have the ability, I won't even call it a right, we still have the ability to move within the states to less, strict or less socialist states, and Idaho's one of them. Well, Idaho does have some benefits
to it. That was the idea, wasn't it, of having the states separate is to have a market.
Right.
You could go run to this place or that place depending on what you needed.
Then Hamilton created this beast called the federal government.
Yeah.
Son of a monkey's uncle. Why didn't he get shot 10 years earlier?
Yeah, we need to have Aaron Burr Day.
Exactly. No doubt. That's pretty cool. So what did you think about Switzerland? Because I saw that they are actually allowing people from outside to buy land there now and actually move there, which is the first time in I don't know how long. I don't remember that, but how long it's been, but they're actually letting outsiders, foreigners, buy property there and move there.
I don't know anything about that in particular, but when I was there, I was in Geneva and Lausanne, and then I went to Montreux briefly. So I was just on Lac Leman. So I didn't get to the German-speaking part. I was in the French-speaking part.
Mm.
But the contrast between France and Switzerland, France and the French-speaking part of Switzerland was pretty stark. It was fun to get across the border and see. Next to my hotel was a used car lot, and there was a Dodge Viper and a Dodge Caravan in the lot. And it was like, oh, am I in America? Or I didn't see that. I didn't see junky big American cars in France, which was funny. But culturally very different as well. And I guess the deal with Swiss citizenship is if you get it or if you have it and you leave and give it up, you cannot get it back.
Wow. So they take it serious.
I believe that is the deal. They take it super seriously. However, and this may be outdated information, but you can live there as a non-citizen.
Mm-hmm.
And, they have these things called cantons there, which are kind of like states. And the cantons still have a really high degree of independence. Many of them have their own languages. You know, there's German, Italian, and French spoken in Switzerland, depending on where you are. And most people know 3 or 4 languages. And many people know the language of their canton as their first language.
Hmm.
And, you know, there'll only be 3,000 people who speak it or something. Which is cool. That does some really amazing things for maintaining culture, which is really a much more stable force than a nation or a state or something right. like that. You know, culture is kind of timeless
yeah.
if you decide to preserve it. So, yeah, Switzerland was amazing. And so some of these cantons allow you to go there and basically live there as a tourist forever. And the deal is they have a flat tax, a flat amount. So let's say you want to live in, you know, financial escapee Canton X. The tax might be $100,000 per year to live there, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if you make $100,000 per year, the tax rate is 100%. But if you make $10 million per year, the tax rate is 1%.
Right.
Right? Mm-hmm. And so that's a phenomenal place to go if you make a bunch of money. Additionally, because the tax is a fixed amount per person there, the budgeting and stuff is a lot easier to figure out.
Hmm.
So a lot of these places actually have functional social welfare programs because they can actually figure out their budgeting. You know, Swiss bankers being pretty good at what they do.
They are pretty good at what they do.
Yeah.
They're well known.
So you have some schools and hospitals and things like that that run quite efficiently off of large amounts of money from people who relative to other places they could live in the world, are paying very low tax percentages, but very high fixed amounts.
I think if I remember right, the last time I read it, which has probably been 6 months or more, the average GDP per person there is almost $400,000 a year.
That would be pretty nice.
They do pretty well.
In Lausanne, where I spent most of my time, the younger people I met were not making terribly large amounts of money,
mm-hmm.
but they were generally excited about the opportunities that existed.
Mm.
And in Paris, I went to Paris for a few weeks as well. And hung out with some people there, like met some locals. And in contrast, they were exceedingly eager to speak to native English speakers.
Really?
And work on their English skills. And they were kind of aggressively looking at options outside the country because there were no great opportunities in the Paris area for advancing their lives and careers in the way that they had hoped to. And out in the country, it's even worse to an extent.
Well, they're way more towards full-blown commie there, of course, too.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's definitely different. But just, you know, as a contrast, two bordering European states that speak the same language right. on either side of the border, big, big, big cultural difference.
Switzerland's always had some little place in my heart for some reason. There's just something about that place just like... I love it.
Yeah, so
I know they're not totally free, but they are free, and then but they're, you know, they're. I know they have some socialism, but I think it works to a degree there for them because they don't have 330 million people, which is why I think it never can work in America because we just have too many stinking people. But something about Switzerland that just always, plus they've always been able to stay out of their wars, out of the world wars, right? They're always
right. Yeah, you know, they even largely stayed out of the 30 Years' War.
Yeah, and they have all our gold. So there's something to like about that, too.
Right? you know, the cultural aspect is a big deal. Like, that's been a thing. My business partner, Brian, is a big student of culture, which I never have been.
Mm-hmm.
My normal view of culture has been that it's just something that has a bunch of inertia, that doesn't have any thought put into it, and whatever, right. It's kind of garbage, which has just been my experience with it. But he looks at it another way, and it's interesting seeing how much influence a culture has on the outcomes of a certain state structure. Like, you could have the same type of state with three different cultures, and the outcomes would be radically different, even though the laws would be the same.
Yeah.
And that's a thing they have going there as well. But yeah, staying out of war. You know, the 30 years war was a big deal. In Europe and decimated Bavaria and stuff like that, right? And the watchmaking region, specifically in Switzerland, there's these two towns in this little valley where basically all high-end mechanical watch mechanisms have been made forever. They actually sort of got their start in the 30 Years' War because they stayed out of it. And so it was one of the few kind of trade cities that didn't get raped and pillaged and burned to the ground. And so much of their prosperity comes out of maintaining a, you know, a productive society in times of war instead of participating in the wars. Back to, you know, that was 600 years ago or what?
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
Yeah. Yeah, it's pretty interesting. It's just, yeah. It's beautiful there, too.
Yeah.
I mean, I've never been there, but just seeing the pictures, like, oh, my gosh, I could see myself chilling out there for a while. Yeah. No doubt about it. No doubt. You know, I think the culture thing is kind of interesting because I've gone back and forth a little bit on it, too. I've come to the conclusion myself that it is important. So, like, as you know, I always blab about or heritage, right? The American heritage is to be free. Mm-hmm. You stupid Americans. Why do you keep wanting to be ruled by someone when your heritage, your forefathers, you know, the that talked about their ancient forefathers, their ancient constitutions and stuff, were to be free. Leave me alone. You know, coming west. Why did they go west? To be free. It had nothing to do with, you know, whatever, because they wanted to be in a John Wayne film. It's because they wanted to be free. They wanted not just adventure, but they wanted opportunity. An opportunity, opportunity, to where we finally filled the place up, and I thought Alaska was it. Little did I know until I got here. Not quite.
Surprise.
Surprise. So I got to keep pushing west to some island somewhere. I'll find it. But there is something with culture, which is why I think socialism does not do so well here, because America has too many stinking different cultures.
Yeah,
and
you know,
they're all competing with each other.
For sure. I guess there's a book which I can't remember the name of by a French guy who I can also not remember the name of. So this is as anecdotal as it gets. This is me making something up. there was this French property investor guy, and he wrote a book about the upcoming election, which has now passed in France, and he was looking at it from a culture standpoint. And one of the things he commented on in the book, which is apparently, I haven't experienced this personally, but apparently a sentiment that many Europeans have, is that the American experiment in throwing a bunch of people into the melting pot and seeing what happens, they kind of chuckle at that. They're like, of course you have a bunch of conflict, you idiots.
Yeah, right.
But at the same time, that is kind of what makes America, you know, love it or hate it, or love the things you love and hate the things you hate about it, super robust.
Yeah.
Is... it's, you know, it's like genetic diversity in plants or animals or something. You have a lot of cultural diversity, and so there's no single points of failure. It'd be very hard. I mean, on paper, it's easy to imagine, you know, it's something fascistic rising up out of the corporatism that exists here. But there's so many factions that it's really difficult to imagine everybody in the country getting on board with something and going in one direction, which is great.
We almost have a division of labor and culture.
Yeah, that's a really interesting way to look at it. That's really
that would be fun to think about.
That would be.
Hmm. And now I am thinking about it. I got to stop because that's taking me. I'm going to throw that one at Lou Rockwell. What do you think about this one, buddy?
yeah, that's a fun one. Yeah, I mean, you know, multiculturalism and nationalism have their own pros and cons, and they have their own things to say about the other. And you can make a case for either, and you can make a case against either.
And right now, I think it's what is, for better or worse, what's splitting. Well, for better, it's what's splitting American politics and what's splitting the state, with the deep state versus the deep state versus the deep state, is that the nationalism versus culturalism and the multiculturalism. It's what, you know, the divider. You have the alt-rights and the whatevers that are Trumpians.
Yeah.
And I think there's a lot of cultural white people, you know, who aren't, and I'm not saying this basically out of a, from what they're looking at as a racist point of view, but where they see their culture being taken from them. So I think they saw Trump as someone who's going to maybe not bring it back, but at least halt the decimation of their culture. And then there are other cultures who liked socialism. They just seem to do well off of it. So I don't know. It's an interesting thing. But with all those things, America still, when it comes down to making cash money, rocks the world.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah. I mean, that's all there is to it, which is mind-numbing. I mean, how else could we have a government that can spend over $1 trillion a year? I mean, just despite, obviously, we have a Federal Reserve. Mm-hmm. But when you take that out of the picture, we still have, I mean, they still take in $2.5 trillion in taxes every year, and people still feed themselves.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's unbelievable. It's unbelievable how much wealth this stupid country makes.
Well, and it is the reserve currency.
Yeah. And then so we, but then we look at it too, though. Imagine if there was more free, mm-hmm. how wealthy this place would be.
Yeah. You know,
it's unbelievable.
If you measure wealth the way that classical economists did, you know, by subjective value scales, right?
Mm-hmm.
And wealth is measured by how easily you meet your needs, mm-hmm. Or how easily you satisfy your desires for material things. I totally agree with that. I think making a society more free definitely increases that. Measuring it in money, though,
right.
I think you can actually make a case for a soft police state, making people more productive. There's this idea of a productivity optimization curve where on the x-axis on the bottom, you have on the far left side, you have like a beach town in Mexico, and not like a resort town, but just where people live on the beach.
Right.
Like Mexicans live on the beach. Very relaxed, very great place to live, extremely low productivity in terms of dollars. But everybody has all their needs met quite easily, and it's a low stress environment. And then on the far right, you have like a Soviet gulag, right? Where people are actually starving to death, very low productivity, but no one's having their needs met and everybody's dying. And that axis, you could kind of describe that as fear, right? So if, sure. if you're living in a state of kind of tranquility and no fear about resources or the police state, you're on the far left. And then as you progress in fear, you pass through like maybe the United States, and then maybe at the peak might be like Nazi Germany or something, where things are great if you do what you're told and things are terrible if you don't. And then you keep going and you end up in the gulag in Russia where you're just going to die anyway. And on the vertical axis, you have productivity, like output, measurable output, not life satisfaction, but like dollar or material output. And the curve starts really low, like in, you know, your Paradise Mexico place, it's really low. Nazi Germany, your per capita productivity is amazing, but you're right in the middle of the fear spectrum.
Right.
And then you squeeze a little bit harder, you put a little bit more fear into everybody, and then your productivity drops off again. And you have the gulag and people starving to death.
So a bell curve.
It's kind of like a bell curve. Yeah. It's a bell curve with fear on the bottom and productivity. Fear on the bottom axis, the x-axis, and productivity on the y-axis. Mm-hmm. So there's a case to be made if you are measuring people's lives in dollars instead of in wealth per classical economics, that a little bit of police state does some good things for you.
Hmm. Well, and then again, you know, wealth is pretty subjective. I mean, we Americans look at it as dollar bills. Are you a millionaire? And you go to some, you know, island in the South Pacific where a dude wakes up in his hammock, walks over and grabs, you know, something off the tree, munches down on it, goes back and lays down, goes for a little swim in a white beach sand, a white sandy beach, catches a fish. He thinks to himself, man, I'm rich.
yeah. You know? That's how. So Peter Schiff, actually, right. That was one of the things he used to talk about, is measuring wealth in terms of leisure time,
mm-hmm.
instead of dollars, which is an interesting way to do it.
And that's, I think, life longevity can be looked at that way too, because if you look at everything just as in dollars, especially in the American rat race dollars,
mm-hmm.
you might not live very long.
Right.
But if you've got the leisure time to... Because your body's got to be able, your brain's got to reset. I know you've, like, there's been times where I've worked for months, 7 days a week. Mm-hmm. Your brain goes, boop, you're going to die. Your hair gets gray. Your wife goes, you're killing yourself. And you're like, what? No, I'm great. I got to go make some money. But that leisure time, that reset, that's invaluable. Money can't really measure that. And, like, that's why I value moose season so much. It's not just going to kill a moose. Mm-hmm. It's a couple weeks where I take time off and let my brain relax, my body relax, try not to think about work, and just enjoy time with my kids. Mm-hmm. There's huge value in that. It's worth more than the money I tried to make all summer. I mean, it really is.
Yeah, you can't buy that experience. No. You can just save enough money to have the time off to have that experience. But if you never take the time off, then it's worthless.
Exactly. And then there's a point to where if you're trying too hard, where you never can take the time off because you're always behind. You got to go. And I've been in that position too, where I just got to go. Oh, can't go hunting this year. Oh, you know, there's a lot of subjective things in what wealth is, for sure. And I think in America, you can have a little, you know, we still have enough freedom to choose what that wealth value is. What you can go after the things that you want and be successful enough to have the time off. You don't have to be the guy that's making $20 million a year.
Well, yeah, there's still that diversity you know, you're talking about diversity is what makes America strong. You hear that, but from the same people, you hear them wanting to have equalized income,
right?
Or we need to bring the states together under the federal government,
or so guaranteed income.
Diversity of race is a good thing for some reason, but diversity of opportunity is a bad thing.
Even in libertarian circles now, they're talking about guaranteed incomes. It's like, well, a guaranteed income means everyone's poor.
We're all
the same poor.
You know, it's trying to erase envy is a funny thing. Did you ever watch that Harrison Bergeron movie?
Oh, no, I didn't. But, hold on. We're still under the – some things never change.
Yay for Fox News.
You still have to listen to Fox News. The good thing is I get to cut it off.
Aircraft carrier put into service this morning by President Donald Trump.
Gerald Ford said that his time in the Navy convinced him that our lack of military preparation before World War II had only encouraged our enemies to fight harder and harder and harder. He learned a lot. In the future, Ford said, I felt the United States had to be strong. Never again could we allow our military to be anything but the absolute best.
The president in Norfolk, Virginia, and calling on Congress to pass a budget which increases funding for the military. He claims he didn't talk with the Russian ambassador about the Trump campaign while serving as a senator from Alabama, but a new report on now Attorney General Jeff Sessions suggests that's not true.
The Russian ambassador to Washington told his bosses he talked about campaign-related matters with the now Attorney General of the United States. That, according to a new Washington Post report, sources reportedly told the Post Ambassador Sergei Kislyak's conversations with his bosses were intercepted by U.S. spy agencies. If true, it seemingly contradicts a number of statements Sessions made.
Fox's Ellison Barber in Washington. Country singer Scotty McCreery cited after authorities say he had a loaded handgun with him at Raleigh-Durham International Airport. Authorities say they found the gun in the singer's backpack at a security checkpoint July 13th. Fox News. Fair and balanced.
We first opened about 10 years ago. We were small, just a few of us, but it was exciting. I always dreamt of having my own business. It was kind of slow at first, but things started picking up. We had big plans, but in our wildest dreams, we never thought we'd have this much work. Yeah, with so many businesses caught off guard by the storm, Reed Waste Management has never been busier.
What will become of your business after a disaster? Nearly two-thirds of businesses aren't prepared for an emergency, and 40% of businesses that experience a disaster never recover. Make an emergency plan now, before it's too late. For a free online tool that helps you develop an emergency plan to keep your business up and running should disaster strike, visit ready.gov/business. Brought to you by the Federal Emergency Management Agency, the American Red Cross, and the Ad Council.
President Trump using his weekly address to push his Made in America campaign.
We believe that our country is stronger, safer, and more prosperous when we make more of our goods and our products right here in the USA. When we purchase products made in America, the wealth, revenue, and jobs all stay in our country.
to be enjoyed by our people.
While Democrats use their time to rail against the Republican health care plan.
Thank you again for speaking out against Trump Care and all the harm it would do to patients and families nationwide. You are the reason President Trump hasn't signed his awful bill into law yet, and we're only days away from making sure he doesn't ever get the chance.
Washington Senator Patty Murray, the fate of the Republican bill not clear as they don't have the votes for passage, though leaders say they will vote on it next week. One state preparing for the worst.
Baby boomers may remember safety drills in the 60s about nuclear attacks, hiding under school desks to practice avoiding radioactive fallout.
Tell a haunting dream I know so well. When walking home alone one night, my path revealed by candlelight. Ahead I see an open door with no idea what's in store. I glance inside the door to see a hall of mirrors beckon me. I take a breath and step inside, a tale of love and shattered pride. The door slams shut, I start to run, and it seems my journey has begun.
Welcome back, Patriots Submit. My name is Joshua Bennett. We got one more hour. We're up to three. That's one of the different things now, Dave. I remember just even when we went to two, it was so burdensome because we went 1 hour earlier.
So, oh, man.
Oh, my gosh. You whined about it more than anyone. You're like, are you kidding me? I already got up in time to be here at 10. Now you want me here at 9?
Not working.
I'm moving to Canada.
Yep.
This sucks.
Yeah.
So we were just chatting over the break, obviously, and I was just thinking the circle hasn't quite still hasn't made it because this is our own little circle, Bastiat, right? That was
right.
Always my little fun thing. But Aaron's not here. So at first, Mike couldn't be here because he decided he wanted to go sit in the slammer for a while.
Wanted some free housing.
Yeah,
enjoy life there for a while. He just wanted to listen to it on the inside. And he was proselytizing in prison. So that was fine. But then, now he's here. Dave's actually here. Aaron, what are you doing in Georgia? Get your butt back here. Come on. Jeez. Actually, maybe it's him calling him. Let's take the phone call real quick, then we'll get back to fun stuff. Well, this might be fun, too. Hello, caller. Thanks for calling. You're on the air.
Hi there. I think
it's Randy.
Oh, yeah.
Yes. Woo. Randy, we were so hoping you would call. Dave wanted to say hello to you really bad.
Oh, well, hello, Dave.
Hey, Randy. Been missing you, man.
Yeah, I think it's real interesting that you've traveled around and lived in different countries, and I wanted to ask you if you had any particular observations or comments about the health care systems, like in Canada and maybe some of the other countries that you've been at. And a few weeks ago, I was looking up on the Internet trying to figure out some things about Canada. Don't know much about it. Wrote down a few blurbs in which I said, you know, I get the impression that maybe there's longer waiting times. I wrote down little blurbs here that says, like, Chief Justice Beverly McLaughlin of Canada once said, access to a waiting list is not access to health care, but I'm sure they have health care. And one, I also wrote down, Quebec had a prohibition against private health insurance. I don't know if these are very accurate or not. And then one person once said, Dogs can get a hip replacement in under a week, but humans can wait 2 to 3 years. That might be an exaggeration. Anyway, any comments or observations or things you've seen about the healthcare systems in those countries?
Yeah, that is a super good question and really good research on it too. So I would say that I just have my opinion. And I've had some recent experience with the system in Canada, and there are definitely wait times for some stuff. However, it's all taken care of as well. So I know an older gentleman who had a stroke in February and got taken to the ER. And he was in the ER. He was supposed to get a room after, 8 or 9 hours. He was in the ER for like 36 hours, right, on the gurney, which is like, oh, this is an outrage, super brutal, which it kind of was. Like, from my opinion, let's throw money at the problem, take care of it. And you can't do that there. But they moved him into long-term care eventually, and he got free language therapy, and he stayed in a off-hospital long-term care facility for 2 months or 3 months. And he was just released a couple weeks ago, and he's home again. Still doing some recovery and some therapy after the stroke. And he paid $0, which was pretty fortunate for him because he's not particularly well-to-do. Like, he wouldn't have been able to afford care of that level in the States. So, there's an upside and a downside to that, for sure. And generally, I don't have an opinion as to which is better. I actually have health insurance via the company in Idaho, and I have Canadian coverage as a Canadian resident. So I don't really have an opinion on which one is better anymore because I can just pick. But for a lot of people, having their health care needs taken care of, even if the service isn't A+, it certainly isn't, C or C- there. Maybe it's B+. But that's better than a lot of people get in reality in the States. However, if you have something urgent happen and really need somebody to move on it, yeah, you got to wait in line. And that can be a huge bummer. Like, if you have cancer or something like that, that can be a big deal. However, no one is keeping you in the country for treatment. You can leave Canada and go get treated in Mexico or Singapore or in the States. There's a lot of medical tourism to the States that Canadians have. So it's different. It's different. And the cultural difference between Canada and the U.S. Factors in to that. If you took people from an American culture and gave them a system like the Canadians have, I don't think it would work. And if you put Canadians in the U.S. system, I don't think that would work either. They would all worry about their health care way too much, and they would vote in the policy that they have right now in a matter of years, so they wouldn't have to worry about it. So that would be my short version of that. And then the other version of that, or the longer version, being cynical of the U.S. would be, okay, in the U.S. you have these amazing private companies that provide health care. Some of them are amazing. But if you want to talk about private health insurance in the U.S., it's really hard for me to talk about American insurance companies as models of efficient free market capitalism. after all the bailouts and everything. So they're certainly corporatist. I would say they're on the fascist spectrum, but they're not super, super duper free market either. So in Canada, they kind of just go, it's a cartel. Like, there's a medical cartel between the pharmaceuticals and the insurance companies. So we're just going to have the government do it. And it'll be its own special mess, but it'll be a single mess in one place. It won't be an HMO plus insurance company plus healthcare provider, plus pharmaceutical company, plus American Medical Association mess. So it's better in ways, and it's worse. It's remarkably worse in others, as you have highlighted.
Well, thank you for that perspective. And also, something popped in my mind. I think I've heard that drugs are cheaper in Canada. I think the way I understand it is these pharmaceutical companies that do create these miracle drugs and things in the United States, they, of course, want to sell it for the highest amount that they can, and so they're expensive, compared to some generic drug. But the actual processing and manufacturing of the pills is fairly cheap, so they, they make a little extra money by shipping it over to foreign countries at a cheaper price, and those therefore the foreigners get the benefit of it, but we Americans pay the full market, whatever the pharmaceuticals can command. Do you have any comments on that?
Yeah, that is totally true. I think that's a byproduct of the American patent system to some extent.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's definitely not a market price.
But yeah, I mean that's a downside of living in America. And a lot of those meds you can actually order across the border somewhat legally. Gary North actually had a piece on that. He has or had cancer recently. Mm. And he got a bunch of his meds from Canada because it's like 10 cents on the dollar or something. So
So
that's a pro on the Canadian system. That's part of the reason their healthcare cost, like their socialized healthcare, is not bankrupting their country as quickly as a U.S. system would, because the healthcare costs are much lower, partially because of prescription meds and partially because culturally they're much healthier people, which is just seemingly unrelated, but as far as how much the socialized system costs, directly related.
Okay, thank you. And just on the pharmaceutical thing again, I personally am all in favor of a company being able to charge $1 million per pill if they want to, and if someone's dumb enough to pay that much for a pill. It occurs to me that maybe the development occurs in the United States because they have freedom to charge what they want to charge and therefore can fund research that goes into it. And granted, some foreign countries may get the benefit of that, but we get the benefit of having the industry here in this country, I guess.
That's a really good perspective. That's probably largely true. There are a couple angles on that are fun. One would be, I'll just throw out an example here, like morphine. We're all fans of morphine, and not having some relief from pain when we're being cut open and stuff. You can get for pennies on the dollar largely the same effect from opium, from poppies. And opium from poppies actually has a bunch of subtly psychoactive compounds that go along with the morphine. So you not only get an anesthetic you get a numbing effect. You also get a tranquility effect from the psychoactives. And so, like in Afghanistan, as an example, they have a lot of access to opium right now. But probably not a lot of access to medical morphine. But as far as a medical outcome goes, you don't actually need the patented, ultra-refined medical morphine. You can just use it direct from the plant. So some of those patents in the U.S. have been for really novel drugs that have been great. And some of them have been patenting things that occur in nature and then making the plant illegal as a way of cornering the market. So there's two sides on that one as well, I guess. Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks for the call, Randy.
Okay.
And I'm going to mark this down because this is the progression of 6 years of Patriots Lament. Randy and Dave just had a congenial talk with each other, and no one called each other an idiot, a moron, a statist, or I can't believe we still let you call the show. So my wife's family, on her mom's side, immigrated from Holland to Canada. So they're all Canucks. And her uncle was just here last week. And he lives in Vancouver, Canada, mm-hmm. BC. And he just went through cancer. And we talked about the healthcare systems, America versus Canada. And before I get into that, the one thing I want to say about this is part of the story too, I guess, but one of the things about pharmaceuticals in the States, to where where I disagree with them charging $1 million per pill, mm-hmm. and I don't think that's anti-free market, because these pharmaceuticals get funding from the United States government, which is stolen goods from me. Mm-hmm. I pay for them to do their research so they can make their pills, much like the military industrial complex uses taxpayers' money to research and develop new weapons to kill people, and then they get to sell it to Saudi Arabia. I don't reap any of the financial benefits from that, but I paid for their research and development. So that's one of the things where I don't agree with them being able to sell it for whatever they want, because they didn't come to the means of finding that pill or whatever that pharmacy in legitimate means. Mm-hmm. They stole it.
Yeah, a lot of times it was subsidized. Yeah. A lot of the cost is all the FDA
right. it's,
testing
it's
and certification.
The right. The government helps out. That's why pharmaceuticals send their people and they end up being in charge of the FDA. I mean, that's just a fact. So we talked about the difference between Canadian and American socialized medicine. And he said, you know, I just don't understand. He goes, what's your tax bracket, blah, blah, blah. I said, well, it's, you know, pretty much 40%. He said, so you're paying 40% and you don't have free health care? He said, I pay less than that. And he's wealthy. He's got a couple properties that are worth over $1 million. Mm-hmm. And his property taxes are just about the same as mine for my house. And my house isn't worth $1 million. Right? And so he's paying less than I do in percentage-wise for income tax. And he has everything taken care of. And he did bring up there was one medicine after he had his chemotherapy that he said he had to pay $3,000 out of pocket for. And the medicine, it was there's a total of $18,000, six different treatments he had to do. In the States, the exact same treatment, he said, is $60,000 per treatment times six. And you obviously pay that out of pocket. Mm-hmm. The other thing we talked about was like, I don't qualify for Obamacare, mm-hmm. right? But since Obamacare, before Obamacare came out, we had health insurance for my family, and there's 10 of us, and it was about $1,200. The most it got was about $1,800 a month. And we finally dropped it. We got dropped because our insurance company had to leave the state. They were no longer, they didn't fit the guidelines of Obamacare. So just a couple months ago, I thought, I wonder what it costs. So I called up the Obamacare people and I said, so do I qualify? And they said, nope, I already knew that. And they said, but they're supposed to help you find the cheapest health care for your family, right? In the private industry too. So they looked around and everything. For me to get health insurance now, be $5,600 a month.
Yeah, my business partner ran into that.
So I was like, well, I can't afford that. Or I'm not, I don't care, I'm not buying it. But so he said that in Canada, it works great. And I said, well, what about the waiting lines? Is that just American, you know, conservative propaganda or whatever? He said, no, there are some things. They do look at some things like, okay, this granny needs a new hip. Is that the most important thing these resources should go to? And he's saying that from experience because his mom, my wife's grandmother, I think it took her 2 years to get a new hip. And it bothered her for a long time, but she finally got it. Mm-hmm. But he said there are also, he said, don't think that, you know, it's the only thing you can do is go to these socialist hospitals. He said there's still private walk-in clinics.
Oh, okay.
He said the thing is you got to pay some cash money out of pocket to actually go to those. He said, so if you don't want to wait, you can go to a clinic and get it done. He said the government will reimburse some of it, but not all of it. You'll have to kick out some of it. So on that area, it sounds a lot like ours. And we started to talk about the differences. Why doesn't it work in America, blah, blah, blah. And I think there's a couple different things. For one, I think it's culture. Mm-hmm. The Canadians are used to being socialist. Look at Europe. Europe has no, I mean, you'd probably be hard to find three people in all of Europe that thought that, you know, besides whatever the guys from the Mises Institute, that thought that socialized medicine was wrong. They think that healthcare is a right. Okay, that's just in their nature. In America, it's different. We have too many people that say, you're stealing from me and giving it to them. Healthcare is not a right. Oh, it's a socialist system. So I think it doesn't work on that area. The other area, we're already taxed to oblivion, you know, in my mind, I think, for, you know, 0.4% is too much. But all of our money goes to the military. We spend $1.5 trillion a year for the United States military after it's all said and done. That's half of all the money the government spends. Mm-hmm. They can't afford socialized medicine. They just flat can't afford it. They don't take in enough. They can't borrow enough. The other thing I think that why it can never work is because I also think in Canada, the politicians there might actually think that it is a right of the people to have socialized medicine. I don't think that anyone in Washington, D.C. gives a flying flip. In fact, last week there was a story I read that when the Republicans are trying to do their repeal and replace, it came out with this expose, a whistleblower. 97% of the Republican congressmen were buying stock in the company that they were going to replace Obamacare with.
Right. Yeah, and
they're just a bunch of crooks.
Yeah,
and so it can't work because they,
right.
We have a bunch of corporatist, elitist, punk crooks that are just looking out for the bottom line in their pocket.
Right.
Because we have a fascist state.
Yeah, and another
can't
thing
work here.
Yeah, another thing I was reading about, and
we have too many people too.
Yeah, and another thing I was reading about and experienced as well is that the an insurance company. Will, for example, you say you go into the hospital and you pay cash,
mm-hmm.
pay a lot of money. Okay, an insurance company
yeah.
will often broker with the hospital so that they only have to pay 50 cents
right.
on that price. So the hospital is going to move the cost over to the cash payer. And so that jacks up the listed price for a hospital visit.
Yep.
And so now you're mixing in the corporatist model with the socialist model. So now you have a mess on both sides.
Yeah. Well, he asked me, he said, well, what do you think? And he already knew the answer. He said, what do you think would work in the United States? How do you fix your problem? I said, it's easy. Get the government completely out of healthcare, from licensing doctors to prescribing drugs, you know, the FDA, all of it, no government involvement whatsoever. Let the free market figure it out. Let insurance companies fight each other out for the competition. There should be no such thing as state, you know, state borders where you can't buy insurance. I mean, that's all BS. It's all right. State-mandated crap that make it harder for us to live. Right. Get rid of all of it. I said the free market would figure it out. And he's a Canadian. He's not an American. He's like, yep, you're right. That's probably the only thing in America that would work. And he saw it. He's like, yeah, you're probably right, because Americans are too different. There are still too many Americans, even though they have no idea why, they think, well, socialism's just nasty. I don't like commies for some reason. They don't know why. They're fascist or they are communist. They don't know that they are. But for some reason, the healthcare thing sticks in their craw. Just leave it alone. I heard a doctor on the Tom Woods show. He's been on a couple times. He has a practice in Oregon. He only accepts cash. Mm-hmm. And he's 1/10th to 1/50th of the cost of a hospital. And he does everything.
And
he does
a lot.
Surgeries,
yeah.
Bones, blah, blah, blah. And he charges cash. And he's 1/10th to 50% cheap, or 50 times cheaper than a hospital.
And there's been a lot of those clinics pop up around the country. Because,
and he's rich.
Yeah. And there's been a lot of those. Well, there's been a lot of those that have popped up around the country because people can't afford the Obamacare or the insurance alternative anymore. And so the market answered the call.
Well, and then like Dave said too, his company's got the best of both worlds.
Yep, playing it both ways.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Which I think there's something to that. You can beat your head against the wall all your life and at the end of the day go, well, that amounted to nothing.
Yeah. Well, you know, the idea that anything is better than anything else is really prevalent in America, and opportunism is really, really prevalent too. Mm-hmm. And I think opportunism is great in a market sense. And I think when you introduce social welfare, it becomes the opposite of that. This is the production of bads that Hans Hoppe talks about.
Right.
So if you have opportunistic people, they will bring a social welfare state to its knees, which is what Americans do. I have a quick cultural anecdote. So, you know, here's a U.S. passport, and on it it says United States of America, right?
Mm-hmm.
And here is a Canadian permanent residency card. And what does it say up there?
Government of Canada.
It says Government of Canada. It doesn't say Canada. It says Government of Canada.
Huh.
This is not
contrast,
Canada.
Right.
This is the Government of Canada.
Right.
My passport does not say the Government of the United States of America. It says, bam, United States of America.
Yep.
So that is not a subtle thing. That's a big deal.
We've been talking about that since day one on this radio show. Since we first started, we've talked about that. They are not America.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Right, and that distinction is actually made in all these Canadian administrations.
In the socialist countries, they figure it out.
Well, in right. one of them anyway, you know.
Not here. No. We are America.
Yeah, we are the America, state. This, you know, right. The state is us.
Sing to
yeah.
the state. We pledge allegiance to Uncle Sam. Well, we got a full board of calls. You want to take them, Dave?
Sure.
They're probably all calling to talk to you anyways. But I remember back when you said Lisa was...
Full sellout. Full sellout.
Why don't you leave? Hello, caller. You're on with Dave Giesel, Mike Anderson, and myself.
Morning, gentlemen. How are you?
Good.
Morning, good.
Yeah, I got some comments, I guess, about the healthcare thing. My father used to talk about, you know, he grew up in the 60s, about whenever the healthcare discussion came up, he talked about how the fact that he grew up, you know, in a farm community, and you know, everybody was pretty much middle class, and everybody he knew could afford to have the doctor come to his house when they needed their, you know, regular medical care. And only the time when he was like a teenager, people started buying like catastrophic policies.
Right.
Very cheap, very minimal cost, and you only used them if, you know, you had a heart attack or something, really, you broke your leg and had to be rushed to the hospital and your doctor couldn't come out. And, you know, he always said that it was the cronyism that wrecked it, because I think you guys said earlier, I think it was Mike that said, all the costs then got shifted to the cash payers once people got transitioned off the catastrophic insurance policies onto these so-called, you know, broad coverage policies or whatever. So as the government's got more involved and all the cronyism and all these different the insurance companies, the government and the AMA and everything else, that just continues to heap the cost on. But even back in the 60s, when everybody pretty much paid cash, the United States was considered to have the best medical care in the world. And now we've dropped from that, I think, considerably. I think the last thing I looked at was like we're like 18th or something. So we're not even at, you know, near the top. And yet, you know, I had a similar experience that Bennett had with our health insurance after Obamacare just got to the point where we couldn't afford it. You know, it went from $400 a month to $1,400 a month with a $15 per person deductible, and it's like, who can afford that? You know, and if we could get back to the old days, which is probably never going to happen, you know, that would fix all of our problems.
You know, I think there's another point to it, too, that Americans have turned into such little nanny state little punks that they think everything has to be, someone has to take care of them, right? When I was a kid, and even with my kids, it's like, well, he's almost dead. We might want to take him to the hospital now or see a doctor, right? Mm-hmm. You didn't go to the doctor for anything. We never went. We had a cough or a cold or cut yourself. I mean, I freaking cut my arm when I was like 8. And I was bleeding like a stuck pig all the way down to the bones. My mom was like, oh, that's going to hurt for a couple days. And now you tweak your finger and they're like, oh, we got to go to the hospital. Oh, you know, it's just like the stupid commercials, like, make sure you wash your hands 15 times a day. Don't get any dirt in your mouth. But we're just turned into a bunch of sissified grannies. Mm-hmm. We don't need to go to the hospital and see a doctor for every stupid little thing that happens. And don't think that that doesn't drive up costs, because you got a professional that spent a couple hundred thousand dollars to be a doctor, and somebody comes in because he doesn't feel quite right. He's got a headache. And he's like, okay, well, that's why God created aspirin and ibuprofen. Go take one and go home, you jackass. I mean, we have become, Americans are the worst. We're just a bunch of granny nanny staters that we think doctors are the end-all be-all. You don't need a doctor. Some of the old witch brews that your mom figured out and got up and put on you, they worked. Mm-hmm. Like the old mustard pack when you had the cold. Mm-hmm. It knocked the phlegm out. The things when you know, a little bit of lemon juice or onion juice in your ear when you had an earache. It worked. Mm-hmm. You didn't have to go in and get it flogged out and have a $4,000 bill because the doctor's like, I got better things to do and look at your stupid ear. I mean, there are reasons we have doctors, but I mean, look at, I was just watching the man, Dr. Paul, the other day on his Liberty Report, and when he was a doctor, when he started out, he made $3 an hour, and he loved it. And it didn't cost him $150,000 to be a doctor. It didn't, you know, it's just, I don't know.
Well, in 60, I just read a poll, 67% of Americans believe that it is the government's responsibility to provide people with health care.
Yeah.
And that's where the mentality has gotten.
I'd say 90% of Americans suck too, so it doesn't really right. matter.
You know, that's one of your points was the, you know, the door-to-door doctor, and that's a thing with the quality of outcomes versus the cost of treatment,
yeah.
right? You could look at it that way too. And since the 60s or 50s, you know, with the door-to-door doctor, you got to be in your own house, for one.
Yeah.
If you got sick, you were in your own home. And a lot of being sick is not feeling good, right? People say, I don't feel good.
Mm-hmm.
And feeling good is really what you want more than a clinical outcome. And so it's probably a lot easier to make people feel good when they were at home. Around their family and their house and stuff. But all of the new, I won't say all, much of the new technology in medicine, you know, big MRI machines and fancy x-ray stuff, and they have like three-dimensional x-ray tumor stuff. My business partner actually designed one of those. They are tremendously expensive. And they only improve outcomes by, you know, single-digit percentages over non-treatment or very basic treatment. So the idea that no expense should be spared for a treatment, even if it doesn't work better than doing nothing or doing something that's very low cost, is another problem that Americans have culturally with healthcare.
Yeah.
Like. Everybody who's listening to this radio show is going to die, and I am going to die.
Whoa.
And so, yeah. So
Dave's mixing it up again.
The belief that, you know, if we just spend enough on money, healthcare, no one's ever going to have to die again, probably has been to the detriment of the outcomes to dollar ratio.
You know, the last time I had my eyes checked, because I'm wearing contacts now, went up in the world. Anyways. So when I first got glasses, the guy was like, he just had this $150,000 machine, just got it. He's like, mm-hmm. look in this thing. And it was like $20 more, $50 more, I don't know. But he could read my eyeball with this thing. He showed me this awesome scan. I still got the picture at home. He's like, oh, see, this is happening. He said, when you come in, I'll take a picture of this machine, blah, blah, blah. Well, last year I went back in, and he's like, okay, let's take the picture. And I said, do I really have to? He's like, oh, no, not really. He said, I can see what's going on without it. So I was like, what about your $150,000 machine? Oh, we're good. Let's see. Well, yep, okay. You know, he did the old-fashioned click, 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 boom. Here's what you need. I went out the door. Oh, I can see.
Well, like how much about
is
a year
it,
ago.
How much is it even necessary? It's just toys.
Right. About a year ago, I had to go into the emergency room and get I was breaking up a dog, a fight with my dog team. And my hand got tore up pretty good. And it turned out I needed 3 stitches. And I don't have insurance. I pay out of pocket. And my bill was $1,300. Now, about 9 months after that, I had a pup that got tore up really bad. She ended up needing about 40 staples to staple her back together again. Her mm-hmm. bill at the vet was under $100.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, so Steve I had Floyd's to go pretty in, good at putting stitches.
Nobody came to my house, you know, and I still paid under $100. But, you know, there's concierge service doctors now that I heard about on another radio program that are kind of popping up, sounds like in the western states, where one doctor will take you on as a patient. You pay just $100 a month, flat fee, for all your kind of basic stuff. And you can call him at home any time of the day or night, and he comes out to your house. And then these guys just have like 500 patients, all paying them $100 a month. And anything that he can do himself is covered. But they've completely cut out the government and everything else. And it's actually another radio program that's on this station in the afternoon. The guy comes on and talks about this once in a while. So, I mean, the best, I don't know how it would need to be done. The best thing that could happen with this whole healthcare remodification, overhaul, whatever, would be to set it up to encourage doctors to do that.
That's really cool. That's like Uber for doctors or something.
Yeah.
Right. It's exactly what it is.
Yeah, the state's got to fall, burn to the ground, and never come back. And then it really does. I know that's my answer to everything, but that really does fix everything we talk about here.
And that's, that may be probably the most valuable thing that came out of Obamacare is the popping up of these little free market clinics.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
When I'm on my island, that's what I'm going to have. I'm going to have my own doctor.
Yeah, don't criticize it 100%. I mean, Obama did us a favor in that respect. Right?
How does that
like to give anyone credit.
Do you know how those door-to-door doctors work in some place like Fairbanks where you have the certificate of need?
I have no idea.
What show is it? Maybe we can...
Is that Health Talk?
The Sean Hannity show. He talks about it every once in a while. Oh. He's got a guest doctor that comes on. And I listen to him kind of when I got nothing else to listen to.
I banned myself from that show.
He does have some good guests on there.
Yeah, who's the doctor's name? Like, people can probably look up YouTube clips of it.
I'm sorry, I don't even remember. But if I hear it again, I'll call back with that info, let folks know. But I don't know a lot of the details. I just one of those things where I'm doing something else and I'm kind of halfway listening, not making any type of real thorough notes on it or anything. But if you listen to the program, it's likely you'll catch him. I feel like he's got him on there once or maybe once a week, once every other week. He's got this guy coming on.
Yeah, I know he's had a guy, maybe the same guy too, that does alternative cancer treatments that the government shut down a few times, and he's like batting 97%.
I think that's a different guy.
Okay.
But it's kind of along the same things. It's like he's cut everything out. It's totally just like hiring somebody off the street to come work on your house. There's nobody else involved.
Yeah, well, it's like Uber. And why can't it be like Uber? Where, Dave, where you just get on your cell phone, you hit your app, boom. Tell it what you need, boom.
Broken arm. Yeah. Little car driving around 5 minutes.
Boom.
Your doctor will be... Yeah.
Well, you're going to have a lot better chance of survival if you're in your own house and going to a hospital contracting some disease while you're in there and dying from that. What do you die of? A broken arm? What?
Yeah.
Well, this guy's a little bit different than that. It's more like, okay, I'm going to be your doctor, so you're going to pay me my $100 a month.
Yeah, subscriptions.
And then you're going to have open access to me.
Yeah.
You know, so you might call the guy twice a year.
Yeah, it's like having an attorney, kind of. Like you get, you pay your attorney an annual fee, and if you need them, they're there. And if you don't need them, they still collect the fee.
Right, and that way he can have a lot of customers and still make,
insurance.
Just $500,000 a year or whatever it is.
Yeah, that's really cool.
Real insurance.
So, yeah. But hey, guys, thanks for taking my call. That's all I got for you.
Appreciate it.
Thanks.
Yeah, I don't know. It kind of sounds like a market solution, but I'll reserve judgment. Hello, caller, you're up next.
Is that me?
Oof. Yep.
Sorry about that. Oh. I never can tell when I'm up. I was just listening to you today. What a great show, as usual.
Thanks.
I was thinking that insurance is just a gamble, the same scam as Social Security. You keep giving, you give them that money, you give them money, and give them money, and some people just die, and so their Social Security is kept by the government, and then the same with the insurance company, they've raised all of the prices of medical care just because they can with their corner on the market, and so those people that can't afford it are, they're going to die anyway, but most of us are. But I think that if
all
they take away all that, all the scams on that raises all the prices, because the insurance company will pay this, and so the person, in the other way around, it used to be that if you paid cash, you got a break, because they didn't have to deal with all that paperwork and stuff.
Yeah.
But then when you think about all the poisons that the federal government has allowed to be put on all the people. Then the federal government, which is broke, owes everybody their health care because they've poisoned us all. So when you get, then at least they're accountable for all their poisons that they're putting in the people to actually keep them addicted to the doctors too. As a matter of fact, I had a friend who was told she had 2 weeks to live, and they wanted to do all this stuff to her, test to her. She quit and went. And followed Dr. Hulda Clark's method, and she lived another 17 years. And the same for me. I was diagnosed with cancer, and I refused to go to, well, Obamacare came up, and so I refused to support the government scam. And I'm still living, even now it's 17 years after I was diagnosed with cervical cancer. And I'm doing pretty good still. There are times when I can't move, but for the most part, I'm doing pretty good. Then you got to think about Alaska. They have a population of 739,828 people. They have a budget of 4.2 million. The cost of administration per person and the taxes is $5,677 for per person is paying just for administration, plus on top of all the other taxes past that $5,000, almost $6,000 per person. So when you get down to it, if you just get all of the people who have a finger in your dollar, the government scam, along, then you will. Then the thing is, nobody owes you a living. But if you get rid of all those people that put their fingers in there, then you can afford your life.
You can actually make a living.
Yeah, and you can afford to pay for doctors or you know. But the insurance companies is the same gamble as Social Security. When you paid all that money in, and it's not going to be there when you get old enough to receive it, or you know, the person down the street is getting the minimum coverage, which is five times the amount that you, you know, she didn't even have any work history, but they give her all this. But then since I have a work history, I only get this. And it's just, I don't know, it's a scam. And then these people, if you know, your husband died and now you're a widow, they'll decide whether they want to give you the husband's stuff, even though you're the widow.
Yep.
And if you work too, they're not going to give you the widow's pay. They're just going to give you your $180 a month to live on, and so you know, you don't get one if you get the other, and so you know, and then the people that died before they even got any, you know, where does that money go? And of course the answer was, oh, it doesn't go anywhere except in their pockets. So I'm just saying, in the end, none of that stuff, when you get right down to it, it's all about rape. And the answer to that is, I'm not yours, and you don't owe me unless I work for you. Okay?
Right.
So
thanks.
They are not leaders. They are public servants. They're supposed to serve us, not steal from us.
Nah, they're criminals.
Yeah.
All right. Thanks, Cicely.
You know, that's... That's a fun point about like life insurance and stuff. I'm sure that you know about this. I did not know about this until recently. As a shareholder in a business, like if you start your own business and you're a shareholder and you have a spouse or significant other, common law or whatever, you can get insurance where if one of the partners in the business dies, the shares go to the widow or, you know, the remaining spouse. The shares are valued at fair market value as determined on the beginning of the fiscal year for the company or by your accountant. And so if you do that same sort of life insurance thing, but you do it for a business, somebody gets paid no matter what.
Right.
And so it's another one of those things where operating as a person, quote unquote,
sucks.
It is really brutal. Yeah. I mean, she totally nailed a lot of the scam there.
Yeah.
But if you do the same thing, if you make a, you know, a corporation or an LLC or something, you do the exact same thing, but you do it in the LLC or the corp, you're good to go.
Yeah, and you can. They have insurances too, where if you have a partnership or a corporation, or if it's smaller, you know, just say two people, that it covers, the insurance covers the value of the shares that the one shareholder held, so the. The other shareholder doesn't have to deal with that person's wife.
Yep, totally. That's
so
right.
So it automatically buys her out. Here's the cash from it, and the other partner has sole ownership now, because you know not everyone wants to deal with somebody else's wife, especially after they lost a spouse or something. They probably don't want to deal with the business.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, there's lots of options out there that for corporations that work. Which I wanted to ask you that, Dave. So we are always. You know, I blame the state for everything because it's legitimate. But people like to blame, like, those evil insurance or the evil corporation, the evil this, the evil that. But how much is it? I mean, if you're in business, your goal, outside of actually ripping people off and stealing, is to maximize profits. If you have shareholders, your goal is to maximize their shareholders, mm-hmm. shareholdings. So how much do you blame an insurance company? Because a lot of these insurance companies, they're not just like they showed up last week. They've been in business for 50 years, 100 years. A lot of them have. They've been in business forever. How much can you blame them for trying to get along in the system where otherwise they'd be bankrupt?
Yeah, I mean, that's an interesting question. That is on the road to complete sellout-dom. That question becomes more nuanced. So there's another way to describe a business, which is the goal of entrepreneurial activity is to create value. Mm-hmm. And since value is only measured in dollars, in America anyway, really, then your more succinct version to maximize profit is correct. In the sense that if we put on our gold bug hats and pretend that we had gold money instead of paper money, maximizing profit would be a different game than trying to maximize the number of paper dollars or digital dollars you pursue. So insurance companies would have to behave differently if they were confined by having actual money instead of currency, in much the way the banks would. So can you blame insurance companies for looking like banks given the current situation? I mean, no, I guess. You can be upset about it for sure, yeah. and it doesn't fit into our concept of justice, but it totally fits into the legal and financial framework that we live in. There's nothing illegal going on, really.
Right.
And
right.
And there's nothing that we all haven't signed up for going on.
They're following the rule of law. Isn't that what Americans are all about?
Yeah. Yeah.
Is the rule of law?
It's an interesting thing with the Middle East. With Sharia law, you know, which we all know of some of its more distinct downsides, but no interest.
Right.
Mm-hmm. No interest. And so their insurance and banking structures look radically different than Western ones. Mm-hmm. And of course, you know, we understand what interest is in an economic sense. You know, it's a time value of money thing. So, but the whole deal in the Quran with no interest was just that people will not be able to do interest-based banking without at some point turning the screws and taking advantage of people. So let's just outlaw it altogether.
Right, they called it usury.
Yeah, exactly. It's
interesting name for it.
Yeah, and they said, you know, any interest is usury. And in with the Israelites, they differentiated. They said there's fair interest,
right?
Which is just time value of money. And then of course Jesus said, if you give somebody money, just never expect to see it back.
Which I've always wondered, does that mean don't give them anything?
give freely, right? I mean, exactly. That's giving freely. Like, here you go.
Yep.
Hope this helps. Yep. Hope you get to a situation where...
which goes back to value not necessarily being monetary. Because you can have a value, the person giving that can see that as wealth for himself.
Yeah, yeah.
And maybe one, the ability, or the Ayn Rand would say, you know, that person did it out of selfish means because it made him feel good.
Yeah.
So, anyway. Yeah, it's an interesting world we live in. I still say I'm my island. We got two more calls, so let's hit them. Hello, caller. Roll through, please.
Yeah, this is Zach.
Hey, Zach, how's it going, brother?
I'm doing pretty good. Good to hear you back, Dave. I got a lot of questions, but I missed the first part of the show, so I'll just let them go. About the loaning money, if everything was measured by value, just by dollars and cents, nobody would sell anything ever. In the fact that if I get a loan from a bank and I get a percentage on it, that money is more valuable to me, regardless of the percentage, as the bank holds on to it. So there is a difference in value for the same amount.
Right.
If that makes sense or not.
Yeah, yeah. Liquidity is a way of describing that. The money you have is more liquid than the money that's in the account.
Okay. And then... one thing I would like to push back to on the insurance being a scam. Yeah, it can be if the government's forcing it to. I could see that being part of it. I would continue to buy insurance regardless. And how I kind of like to when I argue with people about insurance, there's lots of people saying health insurance should be this ticket to health care that right. anything should be paid for. Now, my car insurance does not protect my car. My house insurance does not protect my house. My health insurance does not protect my health. It all protects one thing, and that's my financial standing. It mitigates my financial risks.
Right, and you can't buy a car insurance after you total your car.
No.
Say, oh, I need full coverage on this real quick.
Well, you can. It would just be insuring a wrecked car.
Right. I mean, insurance is a hedge against an unlikely event, a statistically unlikely event.
But for your finances, because it still doesn't protect your health.
Totally.
Your car.
Right. Just like a law against murder doesn't keep you from being able to kill someone.
Yeah, when I got to pay health insurance and I have to pay for maternity leave and maternity care and I'm a single man, really they turned health insurance into a way to just redistribute wealth. That's what they're doing.
Yes.
I mean, they're still buying votes with it.
And that would be the scam. Yeah, the idea of insurance is totally sound, like ethically and
absolutely.
Economically, and it's just the way it's administered. That's a very good distinction.
In a free society, it would be almost necessary. I mean, it would be... I think it
we would
be,
want
I mean,
it.
That's, yeah, I mean,
I even if in certain insurances weren't required by the government, I would still buy them. Yeah. I mean, it protects me.
Well, the insurance was there before they required.
Right, exactly. Government didn't make up insurance.
Right,
Lloyd's of London.
No, they just found a good way to make money off it.
Right.
Yeah.
So I just like to end this on. It's a good thing Cecily still beat cancer. I bet cancer didn't know what it was getting involved with.
Right.
Started to
getting his butt whooped.
Yeah. All right. Hey, good show, guys.
Thanks, man. Appreciate it. Yeah, and I think that that's a good point too, Mike. That people forget who came first on so many different things. Mm-hmm. It's like government didn't create society or communities. Communities were there, but for some reason they created government. I've never understood that one, but oh well. Hello, caller, you're up next. Go fast, please.
Hey, yeah, first hour. This is Charles.
Hey, Charles, how's it going, brother?
Good. In the first hour, you had an ethical question. You know, if you see somebody drowning in a lake or a pool,
right?
What's the right thing to do? Well, pure ethics, I think, would tell you the right thing to do is to help them out, save their life, and afterwards not expect any... monetary, reward for that.
Right.
Reading Socrates' answer to Glaucon in Plato's Republic, we find that justice is a compromise between doing injustice and not being punished, and suffering injustice without the power of retaliation. I was thinking about that when I heard OJ got
a little bit
of time off.
He's getting out.
Yeah, well, I wouldn't want to be him.
Yeah, that's a really interesting point about justice. There's the Clarence Darrow essay, Resist Not Evil.
I was going to bring that up too, buddy. Good.
Yeah.
Right on.
Yeah.
You remember Charles the poet, don't you?
For sure. Yeah, good hearing from you.
Okay, gotta go.
Right,
thanks.
Take care, brother. All right, caller, make it quick. Like,
hello, Josh.
Yes, sir.
Bill, real quick.
Hi,
hey,
Bill.
Talking about old people and retirement stuff a little while ago, and a redneck's retirement is to win the lottery. Well, they called me the other day. Said the publisher's clearinghouse won 9.7 plus a new Mercedes. And I thought, God damn! I called the stupid jerk back twice just to mess with him. Anyway, maybe other people get me calls, but I'm going down to get a rubber ducky ticket today. I have a better chance at 3 o'clock than that. Thank you, folks. Nice
Thanks,
show.
Bill. Great.
Yeah, good luck. Appreciate good luck.
Oh, Bill. That's awesome. Hello, caller. Please make it quick. Come for it.
Never a borrower or a lender be. It makes a slave of you and me. And if you want your health insurance covered, save it. Save that money for yourself. You don't need to give it to somebody else.
All right. Thank you. All right, board is clear. Wow, that's like the most calls we've taken in a month. 2, 3, 4, 5. So, Mr. Giesel, thanks for joining us.
Yeah, thanks for having me on. It's super fun.
Been fun. And I think it's the first time you guys have both been on the show at the same time, right?
Yep,
Mike? I think so.
That's cool. We still haven't figured it out. Dang it, Aaron, you're such a jack. And if you were here, I'd still call you Jack.
That's
say
for
something
sure.
That
That's
would just
sure.
be outrageous. So. What are your plans? Are you heading back to
Yeah, I'm here. I'm here for a couple days, getting some stuff square. This is my first time back in 4 years, 10 months, I think.
Wow.
Here for a couple days, and then back to Idaho briefly to clean up some stuff, and then back to Canada for the rest of August.
Well, keep in touch and keep working on the plans for our island, which is my ultimate goal.
Oh yeah, yeah. Oh. The island is going to be where it's at.
All these problems we talk about. Of course, you know,
we will have a bunch of new and more complicated ones to solve, absolutely, which will be super fun.
But they'll be so fun.
Yeah, yeah.
They'll be so fun. And the answer may not be get rid of the state. We actually might have to think.
We might.
But hopefully not.
Hopefully not. We'll resurrect Murray Rothbard or something.
That'll work. Yeah. All right. So, folks, thanks for participating. It was a lot of fun, of course. Thanks for Adam Dick for joining us. Again, jump on the Ron Paul Institute if you were interested in that. And, you know, we never tell you folks how to spend your money, but I always say if you can donate to that institute, that is the one institute that I say is worthy of, well, there's a few, but it is one of the institutes that's worthy of your pocket change if you can afford it. Dave, have fun back in Canada. You know, it's the one act of aggression that I would have accepted from the American state if they would have taken British Columbia, Yukon, and Northern Territories. What the heck?
Well, the Canadians didn't have to give up D.C. after they burned it to the ground,
too. Yeah, no joke.
I don't know why they did that.
Why did they take it? I would gladly give it to them now.
sure.
All right, folks, we'll see you next week. Thanks for listening. This is Patriots and Men. We'll be right back.